This week, we head on down to Nuketown for a record kill streak as we discuss the 2006 remake of The Hills Have Eyes. Hello and welcome to the Bloody Goods Horror Show. I am your host, Eddie, the ex-person, and joining me as always, the voice that's breathing heavy on the other end of the CB, Tim Yobo. How are you doing today, good sir?
I'm doing very well. I'm really jealous I didn't think about that Nuketown reference.
Ah.
Damn. You think they actually based it? There's a couple of parts of it where it looks like they could have based Nuketown on.
Yeah, there are, Tim, but joining us as always, who ordered the pig in a blanket? It's Candice.
Oh, that pig is so cute.
It's adorable, isn't it?
Don't pet the fucking pig. You can't just walk up to a pig and pet it. No, you don't.
Tim, you have a weird aversion to pork, though. Are you worried the bugs that are in it'll get on you?
I also back up my not eating pork thing is because pigs are very smart animals. It's the same reason why we'll not eat an octopus. Okay, anything that can figure its way out of a trap should not be eaten.
Rats can figure their way out of a trap, too.
No one's eating rats, Eddie.
Yeah. Who's eating rats?
I don't know, man.
That's my trifecta of I will not eat something because they're too smart. Rats, pigs, and octopuses.
So you don't think a cow is smart?
No. If they haven't figured out that one fucking cow is tricking all those other cows going into a fucking building and only one cow comes out, well, they think it's fucking Highlander?
Hmm.
Look, I've been around a lot of cows. They're fucking dumb.
Yeah, they're dumb as shit.
If you can so tip something over while they're sleeping, yeah, that's it.
Chickens and cows are real dumb.
Chickens might be the dumbest fucking animal I've ever dealt with. They are insanely stupid. Fucking, yeah, damn good. So we are here rounding the end of Remake. And this week, Candice, you called an audible midweek, and you said, now, you know what? We have to cover the Hills Have Eyes remake. It's the best remake of all. So, you know what?
Caveat to that. Not the best remake of all time, because that's the thing.
Okay,
it's
fair.
Remake from this time period.
Ooh, would you say The Thing is a better remake or The Fly?
I mean, I got to go with
The Thing.
Yeah.
Really? I don't know. That's a tough one for me.
It is a tough one because they're both phenomenal movies.
The Fly did a lot to change even down to the nature of the dude himself.
It's a good movie, but I don't know what people are going
to say. You might be right, though. I might have to go with you. The Thing might be the perfect horror movie.
Which movie are people still talking about today?
Both.
Fair. Yeah. Well,
I think The Thing gets more lip service about it. Yeah. People more like, holy shit, how did people sleep on this movie?
Yeah, fair. I mean, yeah, and people at the time thinking it was a piece of shit.
Oh, and I want to call a prediction. I want to call a prediction right here.
Okay.
Because
I watched Renfield.
Oh, okay.
And I enjoyed it. And I'm like, it's not a great movie, but it's a fun time. I really liked it.
That could be a movie.
I was like, and you know, the fact that bombed so hard in the box office, I think this movie is going to be a cult classic. I think Renfield, 20 years down the road, people are going to be like, what the fuck were you thinking? This movie was fantastic then.
So you're staking your claim now. So 20 years later, you could be like, well, actually.
Exactly. And it's recorded. And it's on record.
Now, let me timestamp that. 4:20, cut out Candice predicting Renfield is going to be a cult classic. In fact, insert myself saying it's going to be a cult classic.
Because they really go for it in that movie, and they make some real choices in it. So I think that people won't appreciate it now, but I think they'll appreciate it in the future. I think our children will appreciate it more than we did.
Well, in 20 years, when people are listening to this podcast directly with their new devices, maybe they'll cyber mail into the AI that your body your brain has been put into, and they can let you know.
I hope so.
Yeah, send it's been 20 years. Send some bitcoins to my poor widow wife.
Yeah. Oh, they're not going to have Bitcoin in 20 years.
Whatever those coins are by then, whatever it is.
I don't think they're going to do cryptocurrency in 20 years, Tim.
What, you think it's going to, the pyramid's going to collapse by then?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think it'll be around, but I think it'll be around the way that, like, I don't know, like, technically Radio Shack is still around. You can go on their website, you know?
Oh, yeah, so somebody bought the name, and it's not like Radio Shack is still around.
Right, but that's why I say, like, when people are like, oh, this shit's going to go out of business or this shit's going to be gone, like, Toys R Us is still around on the internet.
Well, yeah, but that's not Toys R Us, because Toys R Us was a physical store that you went into and you've discovered toys instead of going on the internet and looking at shit that's being recommended to you because it's got a bunch of fake fucking reviews. Fair. I mean, I know what you're saying. Yes, the name is still around, but it's nowhere near the company what it was.
No, right? No, it's no nowhere near the power level it used to be at, for sure.
I mean, look at Beefsteak Charlie's. They were all over the place. Now where are they?
I've never seen a Beefsteak Charlie's.
I've never even heard of that.
It was an East Coast thing. It was Sizzlers before Sizzlers.
Oh, okay. What,
where's Sizzlers?
They got those out here.
You saw Sizzlers.
It's weird because there still are a couple of Sizzlers out here in California once in a while.
There are some weird restaurants that are still hanging on, like Shoney's. Those exist in certain places. Shoney's.
They're probably owned by a big corporation. And that's they just got the name and,
They just unload.
Yeah.
Like, what's the pizza place with the mojo potatoes?
I don't Shakey's. Know what the fuck you're talking about.
Shakey's
Why don't get
pizza.
Potatoes at a pizza place?
Yeah, who does that?
That's how you know you're in some bullshit fucking tourist pizza place. If you can get french fries with a fucking slice of pizza.
Yeah, if they have sides to go with the pizza, like wings.
Why are you eating
something?
Sides with a pizza that's not garlic knots? Why are you eating anything besides garlic knots at a pizza place?
Why would you ever get wings with a pizza, Candice? Good point.
I wouldn't. I don't. That's unnatural.
What the fuck?
There was this pizzeria that I used to go to in Manhattan called Pizza Suprema. I think it was there before the original Madison Square Garden, all right?
Before Madison Square Garden was there.
The original, not the one that they remade, the original.
Oh, okay.
The original Madison Square Garden.
And it's kind of like just like three or four blocks away from where the new one is now. And man, Jesus Christ, to this day, it's still one of the best slices of pizza I've ever had. And they literally have nothing but pizza. There's no big CD. There's no spaghetti. There's nothing. I don't even think you can get garlic knots.
Hmm. Damn.
But God,
yeah, that's like the In-N-Out burger.
The grandma pizza. Mm.
Yeah, it's like the In-N-Out burger move where they just have nothing on the menu. They're like, well, you want a burger, you want fries, a Coke, that's it.
Do something and do it good, and people are going to go to you, right?
Fair. And speaking of doing something and doing it good, let's get to everybody's favorite segment. Candice, what have you been consuming?
Okay, there's a couple of things I want to talk about.
Okay.
One is, of course, I got The Legend of Zelda, Tears of the Kingdom.
Oh, of course.
I'm so happy your family bought it for you, Candice. It didn't break your heart.
Yeah.
How are they doing now when on their 7-day famine stretch?
Yeah. Which one did you kill and stuff first?
No, watch me play it. I have them on the couch. It's like that Tales from the Crypt episode.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You know that none of those kids are going to be able to play that game when you finish with it, right? You're going to take it out and smash it right in front of them?
I have a digital copy.
Delete it.
Man, that's a game that is a time sink. I like to play handheld, and I'll like all of a sudden my Switch will be dying. It's like 20% battery left. I'm like, how? I just started playing. Look at my watch. That was 3 hours ago.
Jesus.
I was like, holy shit, this game is something else. It's so fucking good. It feels so good to play too. You always know a good game when even just doing a simple thing like picking up a weapon and setting it back down again just feels good.
Mm-hmm.
Just the simplest actions.
It's like an RPG game. What is it?
It's an action-adventure game is what it's characterized as.
Explain the concept of Legend of Zelda games to Tim Yobo.
Well, No. I mean, I got the general concept of it, but I'm like, I'm imagining it's not like super deep into the RPG part. It's more
More like action-adventure because you're exploring.
Like a
you're
fable,
solving,
right?
You're solving puzzles. You're going through like trials. And you're, the fun thing with this one, the big catch, is that your superpowers, you can combine stuff together to make new weapons, or you can combine stuff together to, like, build a bridge if you want to get across a chasm. You can build a fucking raft and put a fan on it and turn it into a boat to get where you want to go. Like, the possibilities, I wouldn't say they're endless, but they're pretty fucking high up there.
Okay. All right. Gotcha. Yeah, like, so you're not locked into playing any one way. You can, there's 8 different ways across that river.
Yeah, like I said, I watched a video clip of a dude making a fucking Gundam in a Zelda game, and I'm like, I'm done. I'm done. That's too much.
It's, well, I mean, you don't have to engage in that. The game can be as simple or as hard as you want it to be, which is also why it's such a good fucking game.
Yep.
There's, like, multiple ways I could try to solve this problem, and I do it the way I know how. I fucking break it. I break open everything.
Wreck-It Candice.
Sometimes that's the most fun way to play, though. It's just like, you know what? Fuck it. Wrecking ball it. Let's get to work.
Silences. So we don't need no silencers on our gun.
I never sneak around, ever.
Oh, I bet you suck at those Hitman games.
Oh, I don't even play them. I'm so terrible.
I just found there was a big update to the Hitman game. Did you see it, Eddie? On Game Pass?
No.
There's a whole bunch of new stuff on it, I think.
Oh, sweet. I got to check that. I love those games, man.
I don't know. Sometimes it's too hard to figure out the fuck I'm supposed to do.
Just takes a lot of patience that I don't have.
The trick is you get into the location and then just blend in and watch how things play out.
Patience. Yeah, it takes patience.
Oh, man, Jesus Christ. How am I going to fucking long going to pretend to be a bartender on this fucking yacht?
Yeah, that tracks for you, Tim. So what else, Candice? What other thing did you...
So I put myself forward as a candidate to be interviewed on a podcast.
Oh, no.
And I was like, you know what? Let me listen to this podcast first. Might be a good idea. I like to jump before I look. I started listening to it, and clearly the people are in their 20s.
Okay.
And their perspective on horror is completely different. And I was started asking people I know in their 20s about horror movies, what they're aware of in general. Mm-hmm. And because, you know, I'm middle-aged. Eddie, you're middle-aged. Tim, you're basically middle-aged. Like,
thank you, Gavis.
But, like, you remember the 70s. Eddie remembers the 80s. I remember the 90s. We had, like, a stepping stone. So we have this idea of what horror is and should be that's built on how we were raised, what we were exposed to when we were young. They were not exposed to 80s movies. They said that 80s horror movies are cheesy and boring.
Oh, yeah?
Too cheesy for them. Their favorite directors are Ari Aster and Robert Eggers.
Ari Candice.
I was you're like,
you're going to tell me 80s movies are boring. I love Ari Aster movies.
Yeah.
Yep. Well, they're slow burn. And I'm wondering, are they talking about the actual movies or growing up and watching on USA where all this shit's been cut out of it?
No, as an adult, they go back and they watch these old movies, you know, doing their homework, and they don't like them. And I think it's because they weren't raised with them. Even in the 90s, I was raised with 80s horror movies. We all were. Or Tim, you weren't raised with them, but you still are like, you see from the 70s to the 80s.
Well,
I
was born in 68. So by the time I'm 10 years old, the horror thing is fully kicked off and everything like that.
Yeah, exactly. So you have this idea of what horror is and should be. And they have a completely different idea because they were never exposed to this when they were young.
And Midsommar. I think they're great movies too. So,
well, that's good, Tim. I don't.
I should replace you on that podcast, Candice.
I like Ari Aster's that Shorty did where the kid was fucking his dad.
I mean, that's hot.
Are you sure my watching God, Eddie. Oh my God. I just remembered that. Oh,
was there something wrong with the Johnsons or something?
Something wrong with the Johnsons.
Dude, you just haven't seen it, Candice? Raping his father. No. It's so good.
Well, Eddie probably shouldn't have spoiled it, but.
spoiled it.
Spoiler.
That's the entire purpose of the fucking short.
Well, I don't think you really get that all the way until the end, unless I'm mistaken, because it was a long time ago since I saw it.
You don't get it until then. He breaks into the bathroom and brutally rapes his father. And Tim's like, I wonder what they're doing.
Wait a second. Are we thinking? Maybe we're thinking about two different things.
Jesus, we must be thinking of two different father-son rape movies. That's a good point.
Well, no, because this one was supposed to be like a whole thing, like a time-lapse thing, or from like when he was a kid all the way to where he was like 50 years old almost. And
I don't remember the kid raping the dad as being a twist. That was no M. Night Shyamalan ass.
What a twist.
Yeah, I mean.
But what I wanted to say is now I realize what I sound like to Tim and other listeners that may have found us because of the grind bin.
Well, that's okay, because like, you know what? Everybody gets most their of turn. Them yeah.
are in their 40s or their 50s or higher. And so, you know, they grew up with different movies than I did. And these kids grew up with, when you're in your 20s, you're a kid to me. Like, these kids grew up with different movies than I did. And this one dude, he said that his first horror movie was Jeepers Creepers, and he was 5 years old. And he watched it on TV.
Ooh. See what I mean? See? That's what I mean. He's watching that shit on USA, where it's broken up with commercials and like any of the gore or sex scenes or anything that makes those movies cut out.
Yeah, plus, I just never get the like, well, I've never seen it because it was out before I was born.
Oh, man, I hate
like,
that
shit. Like, telephones were invented before you were born, too. Right?
Yeah, I know. I understand. I watch old movies, and I enjoy them. Just because they're old doesn't mean they're bad, but that's something that a lot of people don't get.
I won't watch a movie because it's in black and white. Is so yeah.
I won't watch a movie because it's in subtitles. Incredible. I won't watch this because it's from the 60s.
I can understand the subtitle thing more than I can understand I'm not going to watch a movie because it's black and white.
I don't think I have a generalized, like, I won't watch a movie because it fits a specific genre or criteria. Like,
snuff?
I mean, that's like a different, that's a little bit different, Tim. Okay. I don't think you're watching that for artistic merit. I think you're trying to jack your dick off.
But
I guess gay porn, I wouldn't watch just that genre.
My end result here and the conclusion I came to, because I mulled over this for a while, I've been very introspective lately, and it's reflected in my
notes. Over this? Oh, yeah,
she's old. That's what she realized.
Yeah. Mulled over it. Yeah. And I realized that it's okay. It's okay that they don't like these things.
Wow, Candice. That's very enlightened of you.
I need to.
An old lady.
I need to step back and realize that this is what I look like to other people. And soon they'll will look like this to other people. I can't believe you don't like Ari Aster. Those old movies are boring. Yeah. It'll be the same shit over again. It always happens in cycles. But look at this. This is the beauty, Tim. And this is why you will appreciate this. Because I've lived through it. And I saw it all firsthand. And it gave me a unique perspective. And so you've done that too, Tim. Like, you've lived through decades of movies, and you can see the trends, and you can see what has happened, and you can add your own unique perspective to it because you were there when it happened. And you can give the, you know, man on the scene, you know, this is what people were talking about at the time. You know, everybody was talking about this movie.
Oh, yeah. I remember when I was young, I was like, I'm not going to watch Casablanca. That's an old fucking stupid-ass movie, and I already know what happens.
Yep, and you watch it, and you're like,
"Fuck!" Yeah, like, holy fuck, these are great movies. Yeah,
yeah. I recently watched all the Rocky movies; I'd never seen them before. Yeah. So,
Candice, usually go on a podcast with young people about music and see what happens.
I just don't know a whole lot about music; it's not my forte.
The worst thing that ever happened to me with music was when I got my iPod. That was pretty much it for me discovering new music
because of the U2 that was on it.
Well, that, and it was just anything that I liked, I could just download it, put it on my computer, and put it on my iPod, and I didn't have to listen to a radio station anymore that maybe played 10 songs that I knew, but then it was also play something from a new group, and I'd be like, oh, shit, I like them. But after I got my iPod, that was pretty much it for me discovering music.
Well, that was another thing that I wanted to say. Like, these old movies still exist and will always exist, and we love them, but we also got to be open to the new ones, too. You can't be the person who's like, these are only the movies I watch. I won't watch that because that's not my thing.
Don't be that person who says, I don't like Hereditary. Don't be that person that says, I don't like Midsommar.
Look, I don't like Hereditary, okay? I don't like that movie.
Because it's slow and boring, Candice?
I did not think it was scary at all in any shape or form.
Oh, okay. I like trying out the new movies. Like, there's so many.
I usually try them out because who knows? You know, I could surprise myself. Yeah. And sometimes
Dungeons
going
and
in,
Dragons.
Yes, yeah. I did not. I mean, I showed the ticket stub of when I watched the first one in theaters in 2000.
No.
And that was a piece of shit. So going into the new one, I'm like, ooh, I don't know about this. And it's become one of my new favorite movies. I've watched it twice this
weekend.
It's
so good.
It's such a good fucking movie.
Did you check it out yet, Tim?
I got about like 20 minutes into it, and then I had to stop because I didn't have time to watch it all the way through. And I was like, all right, I want to watch this all the way through.
So gotcha,
instead of getting
gotcha.
Halfway through it and then going out and then coming back halfway and finishing, I hate doing that to movies. But
yeah,
and I know some people will be listening to this and think that's rich coming from me saying don't close yourself off to things because it's not what you're used to.
So when are you going to be watching the rest of Breaking Bad, Candice?
Yeah.
Look, I watched the first two seasons. If I don't like it by then, I'm not going to like it, okay?
So now we got to get you on The Wire, okay? If you don't like what some people consider the top, the number one drama show of all time, then you have to watch the one that other people say is the number one show.
I would be so bold as to make the prediction Candice will like The Wire.
I think she will, yes.
Yeah, because I'm more of a Goodfellas than a Godfather person. So is The Wire more like Goodfellas?
No, that's hard to say because Goodfellas is a movie. This is a 5-year fucking
right. No, I get the vibe. I get what you're talking about. You could kind of make that comparison in that it's a little more punchy and a little more brutal. Plus, it's a little more like up to date.
Oh yeah, you know? Definitely. Yeah,
I get
don't know
that.
If it's up to date today.
Yeah, The Wire's
no. I say comparing Goodfellas and The Godfather.
Oh, gotcha.
Right. Because yeah, it's Godfather really takes its time to tell the story, you know? So I could get that. And definitely The Wire, I think The Wire moves at a better clip than Breaking Bad did.
Yes, true. The Wire, yeah. I think if definitely the first season should get you, where Breaking Bad, it's sometimes that first season is a little hard for people to get through.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what about you, Tim? What have you been consuming?
Not too much. Thank God.
Oh,
I've just been watching The Good Doctor, which I can't talk about any of the things on it. I will not talk about the conjoined twin episode.
Oh, what?
Yeah.
Oh,
I know it's
such
got the
it's show.
No, it's got Norman Bates as the
No.
Main
oh yeah, that's right. But here's what's incredible is one of them got accepted to Yale and one of them got accepted to Harvard. What are we gonna do?
Oh no.
Yeah, and then the twist and turn that show takes.
Does the good doctor have to separate them?
They get separated, okay? One of them wants to get separated. The other one doesn't want to, but the other one does it because the other one wants to, right? Mm-hmm. They get separated and... Oh, I forgot. They were also supposed to do something with a kidney transplant from the one on the left to the one on the right.
What?
Right?
Did one of them get up both kidneys or something, and so they needed one of them?
Well, no. While they're doing that, she goes into operation, and the twin that didn't want to have the operation goes into a coma and is brain dead. And now it turns out that the other one can't live without her heart, her sister's heart, helping her heart beat.
She better get it on ice real quick.
Well, no. Their brilliant solution, Candice, is to hook her back up to her brain dead sister.
Okay.
And use her as a life support system until her sister dies of natural causes. And then they can take the heart out and put it in the other sister. So I'm thinking, wow. So this lady's going to be laying in a hospital bed for the next 20 or 30 years, give or take, maybe.
With her dramatic sister who threw a fit because she didn't get her way and went into a coma.
Well, the mom comes up with a solution. Kill the other daughter. Take her off the life support.
That's what I say.
But don't tell the other daughter. Don't let her know that that's why it happened. And wouldn't you know, Candice, when they pull the fucking tube out of the brain dead sister,
she's
breathing.
You. No.
Her eyes open. What are we going to do now?
And the big
Zoinks.
The big problem, the big conflict, though, is that the good doctor won't quit playing Sonic.
It is just, oh my God, such an incredible show. That's all I can really say about it. That's I.
Oh man!
Don't even get me to the one with the no, forget it. No,
yeah.
I can't say.
I think we're gonna have to pay off if we get too much more into that conversation. So I haven't really been consuming much. I finished up that bad Gordon Ramsay cooking competition show.
Why?
I don't know.
This is the third podcast in a row where you bitched about it. Why do you feel the
because
need to finish
it? We'll put something on while we're eating dinner and not pay attention to it, really, but just kind of...
So you want to see people cooking bad and getting yelled at while you're
yeah,
eating.
Right.
It's good for the digestion.
I want to not really pay too much attention. You know what I mean? I want something
put the good doctor
on. That's fair. But no, Tim, so then... And I talked about it in the Discord for a minute. I watched that episode of Hotel Hell.
Mm-hmm.
Dude, this shit is structured like a horror movie.
Yep.
It is fucking insane. I've never seen a more insane episode of a reality show.
Oh, how crazy is that lady? Both of those ladies. I don't know which one's more insane.
Oh my fucking God. But Tim, the waiter, the boy. I forget his name. This dude,
who didn't leave, right?
Yeah. I've gotta find this dude because he's got a future in stand-up. He is so fucking funny in this episode. The way that he just shits all over the woman running the place, like to her face.
Yeah, because he doesn't care. Because the other guy's already quit, and he's like, "Dude, I'm not working to double shift tomorrow by myself. So tonight's my last night. I'm on TV. Let's see if I can get a fucking reality show or maybe a podcast gig out of this."
When Ramsey is, and I don't want to spoil what the answer to this is, but when Ramsey is like, "Dude, this room smells like shit. Why is that?" And he's like, "I don't know. Probably because somebody shit on the floor." Fucking love that kid, dude. So look forward to that one. We're going to be covering that for sure. I gotta circle back with Robbie, though, because I have to have him present for that episode.
Is it okay to keep a freezer outside as long as you put a sheet over it?
God. It's insane.
My favorite thing is, that's my wardrobe. There's no need for you to go inside.
Yeah. Candice, it's filmed in West Virginia.
Gross.
That's all I gotta say.
The closet, the wardrobe that had like fucking, she has like 85 more clothes the next day when she cleaned it out.
Yeah.
Fit into that wardrobe.
It's insane. So the other thing I have to announce is, so I was thinking about our last week for this month, and we were talking about redoing an episode that we've covered before. Mm-hmm. But then I'm conflicted because then Mike in the Grindbin Discord brought up a movie.
Sorry, I'm really excited.
To cover.
Oh, I know. Yeah.
And I thought, you know what? Let's do it. Let's call an audible on it, right? We'll have some fun.
It's our podcast, right?
Fuck yeah. And
we're not getting sponsored by anything for that month.
Just
so,
for remakes.
Do whatever we want.
Yeah.
Our only sponsored episode is for remakes.
And so I think what we're going to be covering next weekend is Titan.
Yes. Mm,
by James Cameron. I
cannot wait for you to watch this movie.
You've never seen it?
No.
Do you know anything about it?
I vaguely
little. All right, don't get any more than vague.
Right. I'm not looking into any fucking thing more about it. So look forward to that one. I've already circled back with Mike. He's confirmed for next Sunday to record.
Yeah, because he turned me on to that movie. He's like, "You got to watch this movie." And I'm like,
"What is it?" Yeah, because he goes into his own Discord, and this poor man is truly a victim of his own circumstance. He goes into his own Discord and laments the fact that he can't cover it.
It's like you have a podcast, but
No. To be fair, look, they have a year where it's cut off, and you can't do the grind bin and start doing stuff like the new Transformers movie, right?
Yeah, so, yeah.
You're locked into. That's why we're here. And that's why Mustachio Podcastio is here.
That's right. We break all the rules.
Except for mustaches.
I don't give a fuck about those podcast rules.
I mean, look at July. We're going to be doing all action movies.
Yep.
Not even going to do fucking horror. How about that? And the name of the show was The Horror Show. Anyhow.
We're rebels.
Well, there's bloody in it, too. There's a lot of blood in action movies.
Right? Yeah. There's also bits in it, so we could cover video games, like I've said. So here we are, though. Oh, by the way, announcement.
There's more body parts than computer bits.
But... bits like 8-bit game system.
That's not very clear. Bit. Bloody bits.
Whatever. By the way, Nick Cage going to be added to... what is it? The
Dead by Daylight.
Dead by Daylight. That's right. Yep. I was wondering if it was that one or another one of those asymmetric horror games. But yeah, can't wait. As himself, too. So perfect. I also saw that Mortal Kombat 1 got announced. They're rebooting that whole franchise. Did you see the two characters that were leaked in the DLC?
Eddie, do you think I didn't see that?
Of course, you nerd. Tim, did you?
There's only one I care about, though.
Tim's dead. So we've got John Cena playing Peacemaker.
Eh.
and Homelander.
Okay, that's not the news that I was going to go with.
What?
You aren't going to mention the
Homelander?
You're not going to mention the fact that Jean-Claude Van Damme is going to be a skin for Johnny Cage?
Okay, I was talking about the characters that were announced, but yes, dude, the character based on the actor, now a skin of the actor.
Which is great because there was a Street Fighter, the movie, the video game. It's like all coming full circle.
We've done it. He's been in Street Fighter and now he'll be in Mortal Kombat.
Wait, there was a video game of Street Fighter, the movie?
Yes, and it was just based on the movie, so it was the actors.
And they did that shitty mocap digitized, like,
CGI.
Yeah,
it looked like Mortal Kombat,
like the old Mortal Kombat games, but Street Fighter and way lower budget.
Was that, like, Super Nintendo?
It was. Super Nintendo, yep.
I'm pretty sure it was Super Nintendo.
Because I know you could play as Raul Julia, so that's good. One of the few games.
Don't use the M. Bison you already got. made you want to make the movie.
You got to give him some kind of tribute. He gave his life for that movie.
I mean, he was digitized in that Addams Family game, I suppose. But very rare you get a Raul Julia in your video game.
That's true.
Yeah.
I bet he showed up.
When was the last
FMV?
Video game that was made from a movie?
Oh.
The last video game that was made from a movie?
Oh, actually, Renfield.
They made a video game?
They made a Vampire Survivors-like game, but you're Renfield, and you're fighting vampires.
No, Candice, I'm talking there's a movie, and then they make a video game.
Renfield.
That movie's brand new. They didn't just make a fucking video game.
Yes, they did.
Okay. My apologies. Okay. So Renfield, what was the last game before Renfield? Okay.
Oh, wow. Okay. Well, there was actually... Fuck. Steam has a lot of them. There's There's a Stranger Things video game.
Oh, yeah.
There's Scott Pilgrim versus the World.
That's an old one, though. That's actually based on the comic before.
I thought it was based on... Oh, okay, you're probably right.
No, because that was a big thing there for a while. It was like every fucking movie got a video game.
Yep.
And then I guess it crashed because there was just never, and none of them were any fucking good.
Yeah, they were never good. Yeah. Well, that was in PlayStation 2 era, and they were making a lot of shovelware.
They got that new Harry,
were in every house.
They got the new Harry Potter game.
Those aren't based on the movies, though. Do they have any likeness of any of the people in the movie?
I don't know.
Is that Dumbledore or something?
Dumbledorf.
Yeah. They make Star Wars games still. Does that count?
True. Yeah. Well, they're loosely based on the movie at this point.
True. Yeah. That's they just kind of do their own thing.
Do you count Battlefront 2? Because you could play as Kylo Ren. And it looked like him. You could take the mask off.
I just re-downloaded Battlefront 2 because I forgot how fucking good that game was, especially that fucking space fighting.
Always remember it as the game that popped the bubble on loot boxes and video games.
Yeah.
Egregious with it.
People got fucking...
Yeah, that's
that,
right.
That
fucking
and,
Boba Fett's fucking spaceship. Holy fuck.
Oh, that man, I got MVP of a round with his spaceship, Slave One.
How good is that goddamn thing, Ken? They just let a bunch of idiots chase you and they just...
And then boom!
Yeah, that and that new, the Diablo handheld game. With the fucking loot boxes. I remember that was a hot minute. People were fucking pissed. Because some dude spent like $5,000 trying to get one item in loot boxes and just didn't get it. It's like
that in every game now. Once somebody made money off of it and people bitched about it, but they still kept spending the money.
Yep.
That's it. Even in baseball, the game that I've been playing crazy with my friend Viles and Westy. It's a free game, but... Yeah. If you want the good cards, the good players, there's only a couple ways of getting them, and a lot of it involves money. You can't even some of the cards you can't even grind out.
Oh
you
shit!
Can't get them.
Since we're bitching about trends in video games, do you guys remember the horse armor scandal in Oblivion?
Yes.
When people were like, "I'm not paying for DLC that's completely useless. It's just cosmetic."
It was like $8 for armor for your horse that did nothing.
Holy fuck!
People were pissed.
Yeah.
Yep.
My favorite was when they started selling mods that were made by other people. Like, they didn't even make the fucking mods.
Oh, yeah. Like the Bethesda Workshop.
Yep. Gross. Anyhow, yeah, can't wait for Starfield. So
and there we go. Folks, we talked to.
There's the bits part of the bloody
there we
bits.
Go.
Okay.
So here we go. The Hills Have Eyes. Candice, you were adamant about wanting to cover this one, so I will leave it up to you, Candice. What is your history with The Hills Have Eyes 2006?
Oh, this was also when I was in college, so I didn't get to watch it in theaters. I had to wait until I had time during breaks. And this was one of those movies, and I was like, holy shit. Again, have movies gone too far?
You son like of a bitch, I have that written down.
Have movies gone too far. Like,
have movies gone too far?
Oh, this
we need to make that a t-shirt.
This blew me away. Also, it's making me so nostalgic for torture porn. Which is a weird sentence no one should ever say,
well,
but...
Yeah, we got to talk about that one day.
I know, and French extremism.
No, I mean your weird...
That's what I was just going to say, yes. Oh. Not the movies, Candice.
Not the movies.
Yeah.
Oh, what a time to be alive in the 2000s, getting to see The Hills Have Eyes remake. Which, I'm not going to say I like this one more than the original, because...
No.
I have a really soft spot for the original. It's not a perfect movie, but... Fuck.
It's good. I mean, it's fucking Wes Craven. Come on.
Exactly.
You know? Okay. So what about you, Tim? What's your history with it?
I remember seeing this probably exactly one time when it came out on bootleg DVD.
Hmm. So you bought it from somebody selling bootleg DVDs in Chinatown?
No, in Flushing. So
Flushing. Okay.
Yeah. So East Chinatown in New York.
Gotcha.
$2.50.
It's worth it. Yeah. Worth every penny, I would say.
Good quality, yeah.
This is another one of them I didn't catch. Yeah, when it came out, I kind of circled back, and I think it was just one of those, we went to Hollywood Video or whatever, and they had a bunch of, you know, copies of whatever. So I had to argue with my group of people, like, oh, well, we want to watch one of the Matrix movies or some shit. And I'm like, all right, I'm going to get The Hills Have Eyes. That sounds like
fun. So you
didn't
see the unrated cut?
No, it was. Oh, I don't think it was Hollywood. I think it was Blockbuster, because I remember it was the unrated cut.
Well, yeah, it had to be Hollywood Video then.
Yeah. So, 2006, Hills Have Eyes, written and directed by Alexander Aja, A-J-A?
Alexandre Aja.
Aja, there we go. Aja. You might remember him from High Tension and...
Oof, yeah.
He's a bloody buddy.
Sure is.
Piranha 3D.
Because Alexander... Well, I say Alexander because the epiglottal R in French is a mouthful. Alexander Aja is, like I said before, one of those dudes that's like, wow, I didn't realize I love so many of his movies, but now that I'm looking at it, I fucking love this director. And he's
what
one of those...
What has he done?
Well, he did, he did Piranha, the Piranha 3D.
Yeah, we did that, yeah.
Love that movie. He did High Tension.
Yeah,
he did
a fantastic movie.
Crawl.
Yep. He did Horns.
He did Horns. Yeah, he's...
Ooh, the Joe Hill story?
Yes.
Okay, with Harry Potter, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's... I wouldn't say every single one of his movies are equally great, but there's a lot of bangers. He did this movie, and you know I fucking love this movie.
Yeah. Yeah, he's got a new one coming out, too, called Never Let Go. So stay tuned
and
for that
you
one.
Know I'm going to watch it.
Of course. Then I just go to some of the starrings here, because we don't have a ton of big names, but we've
really?
Got some character actors. I'm going to start with one of the biggest, of course.
There's horror royalty in this movie.
Ted Levine.
There you go.
Plays Big Bob. And, of course... You should remember him. Buffalo Bill.
He skins his humps.
Yeah. Limited role in this movie, though. You don't see him a ton, right?
Well, I mean, he's a side character, but I'd say he's on screen quite a bit, and he's the driving force for the plot.
Mm-hmm. What was
Which
he better
Which is different
in?
Than most movies, right?
Yeah, that's true. Tim, what was he better in, this or Wild Wild West?
Oh, fuck.
Who was he in Wild Wild West?
He's the guy with the fucking ear fucking horn thing, right?
Yeah, General McGrath.
Oh, I don't know him.
The old Victrola fucking thing in his ear with the fucking wax pouring out of it.
Yeah.
Yeah, we should do that movie. That's a great movie.
Fuck that movie.
No.
You know
that
what?
Movie's gone too far. Yes, this one.
Wait a minute. Does anybody in that have a mustache?
Tim? Kevin Kline has a mustache. Yeah.
There we go. Tim, you and me got to bring it to Daniel's show.
Oh, there we go. Yes.
He'll have fun with that.
I think he's got a roly finger mustache, too.
Yep,
yeah, he does. He's got one of those curlicky ones.
Oh, man. So stay tuned for that one. Big name. Kathleen Quinlan, who plays Ethel, a.k.a. the mother.
Hmm. Every time I see this lady's name, I was like, oh, I know her. And then I see her, I was like, oh, no, I got her mixed up with somebody else, but I also know her.
Yeah, you do know her from the Twilight Zone movie. She was in the segment The Good Life.
That's right.
Oh, sorry, she killed the kids.
Yeah. You also know her from the Doors movie. And you should know her because she's a bloody buddy.
Who? From what?
Event Horizon.
Oh, fuck. That's she's right. The mom in that.
Yep.
She's the mama bear.
See? She's one of those people that even though you know her and you see her, you're still like, wait, do I know her?
She does have pretty generic features. And that sounds harsh.
In this movie, especially Candice. God damn it. Fuck.
Very forgettable face.
Well, you have a lot of unforgettable faces in this movie.
Yeah, everybody like Lizard.
Looks. Yeah, totally lit. We'll get to him. Dan Bird, who plays Bobby, the little boy, mostly did a lot
shithead.
Of television.
I hate that
kid. Yeah. Everybody fucking hates him. I mean, he sucked.
He does. Not suck. Because he's a little Kyle Rittenhouse. I just hate him.
Kyle Ritten.
He is.
He is, yeah. Fair. Emily DeRavine, who plays Brenda, she was in that Carrie made for TV movie back in like 2002, I think.
Oh,
it was.
I actually watched that one.
And she was
I've seen all the Carries.
The blonde one?
Yeah, Brenda.
Yeah, she's also Lost.
Yeah, she was also in Lost, yeah. Tim. I'm not done.
She was also in Eddie. You know I watch it. You know I love it.
Vampire Diaries?
What was she
I just
in?
Took a guess.
I got to look at my notes to see what she was in that you
that thing with the
would
werewolves?
Call out.
I give you a little hint. Mm-hmm. It involves Disney.
Ugh.
She's Belle from Once Upon a Time. Well, from Once Upon a Time, the TV show. She's Belle.
That what's that?
Okay. It's a TV
that
show.
That was a TV
that
show that
like
was
a,
on that only geeks watched.
Gotcha.
Me, I still watch it. It's on Disney Plus. I've watched it like a few times now.
Yeah,
love that fucking show.
I was going to call out that she was in that secret 9/11 movie, Remember Me, with Robert Pattinson, where right at the very end, the plane hits the tower.
Oh, man. We need more movies like that. That's a great fucking gimmick, man. That's really cool.
Secret 9/11 movie.
I think we're past, let's see, yeah, because with every generation, something like with Pearl Harbor, nobody was making Pearl Harbor jokes like for a couple of years. But after a while, I mean, now we make Pearl Harbor jokes, right?
Tim, I don't think Remember Me was meant as a 9/11 joke.
No, but I mean, just like fucking put that shit in movies a little bit more. Stop erasing it from history. It happened.
You're trying to say stop acting like it's sacred and untouchable.
So what do we do then? I guess we have to go back on like a school shooting or something. What's a
Columbine.
School shooting?
Oh, shit. Yeah. Let's make a spoof of Columbine.
Oh, yeah.
A parody.
I already have that the school mapped out in Doom.
Call it
so.
Kyle
See,
on Fine.
Unfortunately, that's always going to be too soon.
Nah, fair. Fair. So we also have Mike Smith as Pluto. Pluto's the big mutant.
A giant one.
Yeah.
One
you might remember him as
the guy with
Super...
the upper arm strength.
Yeah.
Yep. You might remember him as Super Freddy from Dream Child.
Oh, shit. Is he?
Yeah.
Well, no, he's not a bloody buddy.
No, we haven't covered Dream Child. I had to go over this with my wife because she thought we covered part three also. Which we haven't.
We haven't covered as much Nightmare on Elm Street as I thought we had.
No, I tend to like covering either cover it for the wrong reason, which is why we did Friday the 13th Part 1 in the ripoff month, or just not cover the right one. So like cover Halloween 2, the remake, or cover Halloween 3.
We could cover Nightmare on Elm Street 4 because that's my second favorite one and nobody else agrees with me.
We've covered Nightmare on Elm Street 2 and we've covered New Nightmare.
Should do the fourth one.
And yeah, my wife. That,
wow,
that, so that was.
I remember doing a New Nightmare.
No, it was Remastered. That's right.
Yeah, and I said that it was the first requel.
Fair.
Because, it had like Dynasty characters from the original comes back. There's no sequels in this world.
So now we've got Tom Bauer, who plays the gas station clerk. And folks, he was in every two you can think of. He was in Beverly Hills Cop 2. He was in Die Hard 2. But more importantly, he was in the very short-lived series on MTV I love to refer to whenever I can, Dead at 21.
I saw you put that in the blood bank. I was like, what the fuck is this?
I know from a lot of things.
So
that.
It's a show about, you know, Jack Nosworth, speaking of, what do you call it? Event Horizon.
Uh-huh.
You know, he played Baby Bear. He's the star of it, and he was like some kid that they experimented on, and they put these microchips in all these kids' brains that had like a dead man switch in them for their 21st birthday. So him
so
and,
like
and
Logan's
his
run.
Right. So him and his friends were going out to try to figure out how to stop it. Basically.
So it's Logan's Run.
Yeah, it's like Logan's Run sort of meets like what's the Matt Damon where he's always running away from people, and the government's trying to kill him.
Born.
Yeah, like that. So like mix like a Born Identity with Logan's Run. Yeah, Dead at 21.
That's like, pretty fun.
It's all right.
MTV.
Yeah, and it's like 90s MTV, so it's very good.
Oh, that is a look.
Then we got Aaron Stanford, who plays Doug. He was Pyro in X-Men Last Stand.
Ugh.
Is that who he is? Oh, see, I knew I didn't fucking like this kid's face for a reason.
God, that is a terrible, terrible movie.
Yeah? A bad Marvel movie?
This was Marvel before Disney bought them.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, this is, yeah.
And apparently he's also in the 12 Monkeys TV show, which I can't bring myself to watch.
How? Forget it.
Yeah. How do you make a TV show out of the movie 12 Monkeys is the question, right, Tim?
Whatever. Go ahead.
The answer is I don't watch it, so I don't know. then we've got Christ. Vanessa Shaw, who plays Lynn. She was in the 2007 remake of 310 to Yuma. She was in Eyes Wide Shut, right? So worked with one of cinema's kings,
yeah,
of course. And then went right from that to work on Corky Romano.
Oh no! Wow. But she was having whiplash.
Can you imagine that, Tim? You go from like fucking Scorsese to Corky Romano.
She just looks
taking
and she's like
60 takes just to walk into the door, and there's Corky Romano. And
didn't take her long to hit rock bottom.
And that's one of that period of history when Chris Kattan could be the star of a movie.
It was Saturday Night Live. It's all because of fucking Wayne's World. That if Wayne's World didn't fucking hit the way it did, we would have been denied so many fucking masterpieces.
Yeah, like that Superstar movie. The girl that puts her hands in her armpits.
Oh, Molly, who's actually funny.
Molly
in real
Shannon.
Life and everything else I've seen her in, except for Saturday Night Live or, in that movie.
Or the It's Pat movie.
Oh, yeah. That's a classic.
Is there a mustache in that movie?
Oh, did I ever tell you about the Pat I had in real life?
Oh, God.
Where it was like this person who worked at the Harris Teeters next to our apartment.
Mm-hmm.
And me and my roommates couldn't figure out if they were male or female.
Okay.
And so, like, one of my roommates was this, like, pretty good-looking dude, so he went and hit on Pat. I can't remember what their real name was. And, got nothing. So I was like, all right, I'll try. So I, like, you know, tried flirting, got nothing. And we would, like, come up with all these circumstances to get this person to talk to try to figure out what gender they were.
I think the problem
And I was like, oh my God, we have a real-life Pat!
Well, yeah, I think it's hinging on the name of the person being Pat.
Yeah, what was like, the name of the person?
Yeah, I don't remember what her name was, but I think it was like Jennifer.
It was a gender neutral name.
Well,
like,
I would hope so.
It was a total Pat situation.
Unless
it was something like Morgan, you know, guy or girl, you don't know.
Right. In that scenario, you've either got a gender neutral name or you've got like a boy named Sue situation, right? Where it like is named that but looks very masculine. So. That's interesting. Oh, and the other SNL movie, fucking Stewart Saves His Family. We got to cover that one too, Tim.
Oh my God, Jesus, yeah, Jesus Christ, man. Yeah, we could do a podcast just about all the fucking bad Saturday Night Live movies.
Did they ever? They did the Night at the Roxbury one. You got that too?
Yes, they did. Yeah.
Did they ever do one with the cheerleaders? A movie
no.
for them? Okay. No, well, that's good.
There's no way you're getting Molly Shannon and Will Ferrell money together to make a
fair.
Movie, right?
Yeah.
You can afford this, both of them. In your
cast, that's fair.
Wow. Yeah, Jesus, man. There's so many fucking bad movies. All because of Wayne's World.
One sec. My neighbor's drilling. Let me go close the door.
Oh, believe me, I know.
Oh, no, I think they're stopping now. Whatever. Fuck them. So after that, we've got Robert Joy, who plays Lizard. He was in Land of the Dead.
He's in everything.
Fallen.
This is definitely one of those that guys.
One of those that guys. And
the fucked up teeth?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that dude. I just had him as Scary Busey. And he was also in Death Wish 5, Face of Death. He played Flakes.
Oh, that's right. Oh, shit. Yes, that is him. Yes.
And finally, Greg Nicotero, special makeup and effects. He also played Cyst. I don't remember which one of them. I think, was that the guy in Traction?
Yeah, that was the guy with the traction
makes
on
sense.
His head.
Shouts out to him.
Wait, is that him?
Yeah, that's Greg Nicotero.
Yeah. Okay. He did, he's a bloody buddy maybe 100 times over.
Yeah, he's done everything.
Yeah, Jennifer's Body, The Mist, Hostel, Sin City. I mean, so many fucking movies. So that's who I have for my notes. Candice, I know you've got pages and pages of notes. Anything you'd like to add?
Skip ahead 4 minutes at least.
There was everyone skip ahead if you don't want insight. Because this is when me having been on the ground during the time this movie was made, you know, and you guys have too, but you know, you're going to know what I'm talking about. This is the unique perspective I was talking about of having lived through it. Because watching it almost 20 years later, there's so much more that I pick up on now that I had completely went over my head when I was watching it in 2006. Like how super fucking patriotic everyone is in this movie.
Yeah.
And the fact that this movie is directed by a Frenchman in the time period.
I have so many questions about that hippie mom. So many questions.
Yeah, because I was looking up interviews with Aja because I was like, that can't be a coincidence. And it's not a coincidence. He said that he wanted this family to be that stereotypical ultra-patriotic time of the 2000s post-9/11.
Mm-hmm.
And he wanted everybody to be... He said that he remembers seeing all those bumper stickers with the American flags and these colors don't run and all that bullshit. And he wanted to make a commentary on that with this movie. And so that's why you have the dad who's super Republican and guns God and government and, you know, pray to God, but pass me the ammo or whatever it is he says right there.
Making fun of his son-in-law.
And also the fact that an American flag is used twice to kill someone.
Yeah, that's pretty.
Mom has the American flag on her shirt.
Yep, there was a lot of American flags in this movie because he was making a point about how, you know what, maybe all your patriotism kind of sucks and it gets you into shit like this where you have mutant babies because you wouldn't force these people out of the mines. And so
literally by your own creation. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's all about the American imperialism is what he was making a commentary on in this movie. Not subtly.
No.
Didn't realize that when I watched it in 2006. But almost 20 years later, you look at it and you're like, oh, this is so on the nose. Like, how did I not see this?
Oh, yeah. For me, it was as soon as he opens the glove compartment up, takes out a gun and hands it to his son. And the son, this kid's not even like, what, huh? His kid's just like, boom, boom, and I'm like, oh, boy. Okay.
Yeah. And apparently the women don't know how to use guns. Because, of course, a Republican wouldn't teach women how to use a gun. They're not made for fighting.
No, they got a baby, so.
Yeah. They're supposed to take care of the babies, just like the mutant woman. It was her job.
It also made me think of those goddamn freedom fries. God, post-9/11 was a really weird world, wasn't it?
Wait, hold on. Wait, if you go to the Capitol and you go to the cafeteria, are they still called freedom fries? Or when did they, like, when do you think they had to, like, stop calling them? And I'm like,
I assume that got, like, quietly shut down.
Yeah, that's what I mean. On Monday, they were freedom fries. Yeah. And next Monday, they're back to french fries.
No, which is funny because calling them french fries is a stupid American thing.
Because they're not from France.
No, they're from Belgium.
Go to France and ask, have some fries. Let's see what happens.
And they're from Belgium, and they're typically served with mayonnaise and vinegar.
I can go for the vinegar, not the mayonnaise, though.
Malt vinegar? Hell yeah.
Oh, malt vinegar on fries?
It's good on some things, but not on french fries.
Yeah. It's better on hush puppies.
I called someone at work disgusting because they were dipping a sandwich in mayonnaise. Just dipping the sandwich in the mayonnaise.
Weird.
Are you going to HR on Monday?
Yeah, I just looked at her. I was like, that's disgusting.
Thank you. Thank you for doing that. We have to start talking, like, I know as white people, the whole mayo thing, like, oh, mayo ass, white people, whatever.
It's spicy as most white people get on their sandwiches. So.
Yeah, but we got to do something. We got to rebrand it. We got to go get really into aioli. Just start calling it aioli. Get really into aioli. Put some garlic in it. Put herb in it or something.
Find that mayonnaise ketchup combination, right? Ugh.
The pink sauce.
Yeah.
Hey, speaking of, I saw that TikTok pink sauce at the store again. Now it's down from $9 a bottle to $5. And my favorite thing about it is how each bottle is a different shade of pink. That's always good when you're buying sauce at a store.
And there's no consistency. Yeah. There's clearly no quality management done.
No, the stock guy isn't coming by and shaking it enough. That's
I guess so. Whatever the fuck they're... I mean, I hope they're not making them small batch, like individual bottles or something. Something's fucked,
man. Yeah, you gotta start somewhere, right?
Sure, yeah. Not in my fucking stomach, though, let me tell you.
Small batch mayonnaise. Artisanal mayonnaise.
Artisanal. Right? I age my mayonnaise.
Isn't that what aioli is? Artisanal mayonnaise?
Fair, yeah. Just homemade mayonnaise, I guess. So we have a nice, fun cold open here of some people out testing radiation in their cool white suits.
These pictures that are happening during the credits in the opening.
Mm-hmm.
They are not, they're actual pictures of mutated people,
mm-hmm.
but it wasn't because of radiation. It was caused by Agent Orange in Vietnam.
Yeah. Another
America, America,
another subtle jab at American imperialism. But yeah. Cause you get that during the credit sequence, you get a bunch of footage of nukes going off. And then, yeah, just a bunch of,
And it's great too, because that's immediate, like, okay, I'm sorry, I skipped ahead a little bit.
It's all good.
Do you want me to stop so you can talk about the scientists?
No. I mean, basically, the radiation people just get pickaxed to death. That it's nothing. It doesn't add to the story.
Okay.
Not like the government could try to figure out what happened to those people, but...
Yeah.
True. I thought of that as well. But immediately after the kill happens, which is suitably gory and bloody, and you love it,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's a commercial... for, I guess, Kitchen of the Future from the 1950s.
Oh, Candice, see, here's where I come in. I know that. I think I know that definitely from, it had to be at least Mystery Science Theater 3000 did a short on it before a movie. But that's a classic. Look it up on YouTube and see what the Kitchen of the Future was supposed to look like.
Oh. I didn't know that was actually a famous thing. I thought they just found an old commercial and used it.
Well, they did, but yeah, it is a known old commercial.
Gotcha. But yeah, then it's real. Like, you see this beautiful woman and her perfect kitchen and all this futuristic technology, and then you see bombs dropping.
Yep.
It's like, that is so unsubtle.
Just
about,
in the oven and duck
this
and
is
cover.
The lifestyle.
Oh, wait. Cover your duck before you put it in the oven.
Cover this your duck the, and duck and cover.
This is the lifestyle that you are searching for, but this is the cost of it. And you're completely unaware and you don't care. So this is like outsider looking in at America. And that theme runs throughout the entire movie as well.
Yeah. And it's funny because I also relate it to the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, the original, right? Which is like, what happens when you just start kind of thinking you can just write off a population of people and dispose of them? Is that eventually, God, I forget what it comes from, but there's this old proverb that's like...
You move into a bunch of mines, take it over, and kill everybody?
Well, the old proverb is something like, if you don't... The village that won't hold if a village doesn't hold a baby boy, that he'll come back and burn it down for warmth. Right?
Oh, that's pretty awesome. Okay.
Yeah.
I think Thomas Jefferson said that.
Yeah, I think that was Jesus that said that.
That's pretty badass.
Yeah, Jesus wasn't fucking around back in the day.
Oh, shit, to return to Bethlehem.
You'd think like in America, we're as gung-ho about Jesus as we are, you'd think he was a Rambo type, but he really wasn't, you know?
What happened to the guy who wouldn't give the room?
Yeah.
To Jesus being born. What happened to him? Did he go to heaven or hell?
Yeah.
I mean, he's finishing it. He's doing his part of the story, right?
Well, technically, Tim, there was no heaven or hell before Jesus. So.
True.
Yeah. Mm. That was Jesus that
made there be a hell. Oh, that's right. Everybody was like building up in purgatory.
Right.
Waiting for the gates to open up.
It's like the DMV before they open. Everybody's just lining up, looking at their cell phones.
It's like Saigon.
Yeah. Some assholes like me getting appointments. Like, I know I'm going to hell. Let's just get through this. Okay. Nah. So, yeah, we get the nuke montage. And then, like you said, all the Agent Orange pictures of the kids that are going to be on The Good Doctor next week. And then we meet our family that hates each other. Again,
God damn it.
I have written down, what kind of sweet hell is this fucking road trip?
Oh my God.
I forgot to add some stuff to. I have my notes a little mixed up. And I forgot a part that I wanted to mention.
See, the old fashioned notes work better than this.
I guess so. Instead of copying and pasting later on in the day. Oh, I wanted to point out that this is Aja's first American production, and he was handpicked by Wes Craven to make this movie because Craven watched High Tension.
That's right.
This guy gets it. This guy, I think he'll do something good with this. And so he was handpicked. You get a phone call from Wes Craven and he's like, I want you to remake one of my movies. Are you going to say no?
I mean, when High Tension came out, I don't think in America, at least, that we had seen something like that with that kind of brutal nature to it. So that totally makes sense. Oh yeah. I fucking love that movie. So,
but also, sorry.
No, it's all good. So our family hates each other. They all pull over for gas, right? And the guy that works there is just smoking a big old stogie while he's pumping the gas, right? Mm-hmm. So, and we meet our family, and we've got Big Bob, right? Of course, played by Ted Levine. He's your typical
ex-detective, right?
Ex-detective.
Yep. Worked the night shift, so you know he saw some incredible crazy shit.
Him being an ex-detective, and I'm certain his wife did not work. Why are his children so entitled? It's not like they were living high on the hog.
He's one of those cops, Candice.
For some reason, all of those kids are like, I should have gone to Cancun. And it's like, what?
Yeah,
well, yeah,
Blondie.
The drugs are always showing up 3 or 4 ounces late. Couple of grand here missing, couple of grand there.
Yeah, yeah. One of them dirty cops. Yeah, makes sense, Tim. Think that he like stole that Airstream from evidence or something? He's like, yeah,
he's full of cocaine.
Yeah, there was only 2 Airstreams. There wasn't 3.
Wanted to mention at the start of this movie that Aja said that he wanted to take the mean spirit and sociopathic movies from 70s grindhouse and interpret them with a modern sensibility.
Yeah.
What Craven saw in High Tension. He was like, this is a guy who can be brutal, but also look good.
Yeah. Yeah. So while they're all bitching because they're trying to make it to California, they're heading to San Diego and they're driving through the desert, right? Our buddy, the gas station attendant, he goes to head back into his place and he notices a satchel has been left for him. So he just kind of steps over it, ignores it. Then he opens up the door, reaches out, takes it. And it's filled with a bunch of jewelry. There's like a wallet with some cash in it.
Yeah. Oh yeah, and some of the jewelry still attached to body parts.
This is before the family shows up.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. That's just before the family shows up. But and there's a little styrofoam to go box.
And there's a human ear inside of it, and it's got all the earrings still attached. I'm like, fuck it.
They're like mutant cats. Yeah, they brought me a gift.
Well, yeah. So he's like, all right, I guess if they're bribing me, I'll. Because, I mean, I guess we're supposed to assume that they scouted the family and they're trying to bribe the guy.
He's the one who's doing it. He's the one who's sending them on the road, and his payoff for it is they're giving him all the shit that they don't need, right? Which, basically. My question is, dude, after we find out how many fucking times this shit's happened, you got enough money to get the fuck out of that shithole place,
Oh, you
right?
see, like, huge clips of money in his drawer.
Just laying around. What the fuck?
I don't know. I don't know why anybody would do that in a logical situation.
Like, yeah. Well, no, I mean, I would take the money. I would take the jewelry and all that and other shit. You burn the pictures. You get rid of any incriminating evidence.
Yeah, but you don't stay there for another 50 years.
Yeah, no. you sell that shit to a fucking pawn shop and you're on your way.
And you've got to assume that, like, they don't get too many people driving by there. So eventually they're going to turn on him. Right? They're going to get hungry.
No, see, he's their Renfield.
Right, but eventually they're going to get hungry. Because the whole
who
thing
else is going to take over the place? He doesn't have a fucking son or something like that that's lined up to take over the business.
Oh, they could take Brain Dude and put him in there.
Nah. Where did they get that? Look at that fucking headset up thing. And
$5, please.
No, thanks, we Daddy. Don't. We don't pump the gas for you. I can't get out there, you son of a bitch.
It's against the law in the state.
Yeah, yeah. So he, you know, all right, fine. Gives in, goes out there, tells him, hey, listen, there's a shortcut. If you head up about 2 miles, when you get to the fence, just take a left on the dirt road and you'll save a couple hours.
So, well, Eddie, you skipped ahead because why he did this is because the dog got loose. The dog runs into that room and the mother, the young mother who just had the baby, goes in and she sees the bag full of the fucking loot. And yep. He sees that she sees that bag.
Oh, yeah, that's
like, right. He was actually going to let them go. But then she saw something she shouldn't have. And that's when he gives them the new directions for the shortcut.
Yeah. That's always a fun moment in horror movies at the very beginning, like how close they were to just skating, you know?
Yeah. One little thing.
One
wrong turn. Wow.
Yeah.
They should make a movie about that.
Yeah, they should. They could make a couple of them. Yeah. So they go driving out there and complaining the whole time, right? Oh, and God, by the way, yeah. before they drive off, we get some glimpses of them being stalked, right? We get the girl reaches in and steals the red jacket from the car.
Oh, I know her. I have her written down. Is that the little girl from Schindler's List? But
or Don't Look Now.
How fitting that they named her Ruby and she stole a red jacket.
Turns out she's more akin to Attila the Battle Angel than anybody else.
You mean Alita?
Alita, sorry.
Attila the Battle Angel.
It was a sequel.
Alita the Hun.
Right. So they go driving out, and then I just have like, when he pulls the spike strip, the way that it pops out, like it's retractable. And
from
like
the ground, yeah.
Cuts a lizard in half. I don't think just the regular spike strip would do that if you rotate it.
I want to know what are the chances of you putting a spike strip down in the fucking middle of a desert and a lizard pops over it just as you fucking pop it.
That's good timing. Also, I want to point out at the beginning, when the people are testing with the Geiger counters and stuff, there's a really bad CGI fish that they catch.
Oh, yeah. That's a fish from The Simpsons, right?
Oh, there's a couple of CGI birds in this, too. You can spot them.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, and then we'll get to the worst CGI here in a bit, man, because it's coming up soon. So, flattens all four of the truck tires. He goddamn near rams them into a fucking... I mean, he does ram them into a big boulder, but he's like, yeah, you know, protect the baby, and rams into it. They get out. All four tires are flat. The truck is like twisted. The axle snapped, and the guy's like, so what do we do?
You know, I think it's because of this movie, I have a morbid fear of driving across the desert.
You know, Candice, no, it's not even because of this movie. Watch Duel. That'll fucking fuck you up with driving across
the desert. And The Hitcher. Don't pick up Hitchhikers. Yeah, Hitcher, don't run out of fucking gas.
But yeah, what the fuck? Like, no, you're fucked.
Yeah. Texas Chainsaw Massacre, U-Turn. Literally every movie is telling us, whatever you do, don't drive cross-country.
Just fly over these states, people. That's what these movies are telling us, right?
Yeah, that's the message, Tim. What we should do is ignore all of those states, and then Trump won't get elected. Mm. Just don't even give them the time of day. Yeah. So they're 100% fucked, right? It's over 100 degrees out here. No one is coming.
How come none of them noticed that all four of their tires are shredded?
Yeah, how does nobody question that? That's That would be the point too.
My main question is, never mind. All right, the chassis is all fucked up. Yeah, I crashed into a fucking big boulder. But why? One tire blew out? Okay.
Yeah.
Fucking four tires all blew out at the same time?
Yeah, that doesn't happen.
That's when he's bringing out your gun, yeah.
Yeah, because, you know, it surprised me. He's supposed to be a detective, but he doesn't think it's suspicious that all four tires blew out at the exact same time.
Well, he might, because this is when he busts all the guns out and starts handing them out like fucking Halloween candy.
Only to the boys.
Well, yeah.
And not to the Democrat.
Well, that's that Democrat, yeah.
Yeah, he's all like, hey, Democrat, you're anti-gun.
Well, it doesn't help that this guy's like, hey, you know what? Yeah, you're right, because I probably would shoot my foot off.
That's, yeah.
Right?
That's fair.
You don't have to say that, soy boy. Come on.
Soy boy.
Tim going hard on soy boys, man. Look at you.
I really hate this fucking character, the way that they got him portrayed.
Doug sucks, man.
Such an asshole.
He's also fucking just so stupid. Because now the plan is, all right, Dad's going to hike back 8 miles.
Let's split up in the desert.
Yeah. Dad's going to...
One bottle of water.
Oh, God.
Then I already poured most of it on my fucking bald head.
And they're dead. They're going to die out here, regardless of mutants. Wait a second.
Shouldn't the daughter, the wife, give her dad that fucking pussy cap? Instead of the son, her husband, because he's got hair. Dad's fucking bald. The fucking son beating down on his bald head is going to boil that fucking brain a lot.
Wait, doesn't
than
the dad have like a MAGA cap or something?
Yeah,
I mean,
he has
obviously.
A MAGA cap.
No, I think he does put like a baseball cap on.
Is that like a from my cold dead hands hat? Yeah. They didn't have MAGA caps back then. They
it's
just
still a stupid fucking thing for them both split up and go in different directions.
Oh, yeah, it's real dumb.
Yeah, yeah, bad idea. So one goes one way on the road, goes forward, you know, Doug does to maybe find.
Oh, wait a second. So see, the Democrats going forward. Wow. Oh. Dad's going backwards.
Because he's progressive and the other one's just trying to make America great again.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
So, yeah, he heads back to the gas station that's, what was it, 8 miles down the road?
Yeah. And yeah. I did a little math because I was like, I go on 30-minute walks. I can walk 2 miles in 30 minutes if I'm going at a real good clip.
Yeah.
1.5 miles I'm going at a regular pace. But just to make the math a little easier, I was like, let's put 1 mile in 30 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
It would take him 4 hours to get there.
Yeah, another four back, too.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's like, he's like, I'll be back before dark. I'm like, no, you're not, sir. No, you are not.
But they do give him, yeah, because he doesn't even get to the station until it's dark. So him like, oh, I'll be back before it's dark. Like, you won't be halfway done before it's fucking dark, idiot. So then I just have that mom will not get off of her fucking daughter's tits about her tits. She's like,
oh, this mom. This is the Madeline. Very stereotypical uptight mom.
No, I have written down, this is your typical fucking hippie chick, okay? Because the dad
when
says
she, when they become
point,
a mom?
Yeah, when she was young, she was, wow, she was crazy. And now all of a sudden, here she is, she's flipping on that shit. You know she fucking voted for Donald Trump twice, and she'll vote for him a third time.
Mm-hmm. Yep, just one of them that doesn't
pot?
Say it.
Who's smoking pot?
She's oh, like, yeah. She's like, I'd feel much more comfortable if we said a prayer before you left.
No, at that point, I'm like, look, I'm not religious, but I got no problem with that. That's a difficult situation. If there's ever a time for a family prayer, if you're into that, that would be a time. But once she fucking starts freaking out about the pot, I'm like, oh, come on.
That is what she's telling her daughter, like, you shouldn't switch the kid back from breastfeeding in a bottle. You'll confuse it.
Yeah.
I'm like, bitch.
Yeah. Shut up. You don't know what the hell you're talking about.
Oh, yeah. I'm sure the baby's going to starve to death, you fucking moron. Shut up.
Mix that shit up, right? Come on.
Yeah. You got to confuse him. That's a good idea.
The kid doesn't know how good he's got it now, but for that meantime, keep mixing it up.
Yeah. So, yeah, then all of a sudden, just one of their shitty dogs makes a fucking bolt for it.
Okay. I love animals. Right? Don't get me wrong here. And I probably shouldn't start the sentence off like that because that usually means something not good coming at that. But don't you give this dog at least 10 minutes before he comes back? He's out in the fucking wild for the first time. You obviously see they got these dogs on fucking tight leashes for the rest of the fucking movie. They got chains already made up to hook up to the fucking back of the truck so the dogs don't get away. It's a German Shepherd. It's not a little fucking poodle running out into the middle of the woods. Yeah. Right? It's a German Shepherd running around. Explore. Give him fucking 10 minutes before you lose your shit and go fucking following off and end up fucking falling off a fucking mountain.
So, Tim, I know for a fact you've never been to a desert. Candice, have you ever been to a desert?
Oh, Candice.
Candice is dead.
So Candice is getting a drink. She went to the bathroom. Her dog is doing something. But
I lived very near.
You just assumed I've never been to a desert.
Right. I've lived very near the desert. You don't just go out in the desert. You don't just decide, like, I'm going to chase my dog.
Yeah.
And there's shit out there that will kill you.
Mm-hmm. I think, in fact, doesn't he say something already two times about rattlesnakes and scorpions and shit?
Oh, yeah. They're having all these conversations about rattlesnakes. Like, oh, there's one of them that'll kill you if it bites you in 26 seconds. Yeah,
I don't know. Give the dog a couple of fucking minutes to be a dog before you start fucking having a shit fit panic attack, Kyle.
If the dog ran away, the dog's dead. Okay? Just forget about the dog.
No, I wouldn't say the dog is dead. It's not even like you didn't hear like a yelp or whelp or anything like that. The dog just fucking ran away.
He's not chasing the fucking dog.
Fucking family.
In the
desert?
That dog's
been locked in that house, that fucking little fucking trailer with all that fucking baby farts, baby fucking black tar shit coming out. The fucking smell of all of them fucking sweating because the air conditioner doesn't work. Plus, cigarette smoke. That dog's got to run.
Yeah, plus those are German Shepherds, and they're very high energy, high intellect dogs. So if you aren't putting them on like at least 1 hour of rigorous like running and going through courses and stuff, they're going to tear your shit up.
Yeah.
Because they have so high energy.
Yeah, I'm not chasing that dog. That dog's fucked. He ran out in the desert. He's fucked.
So give him 10 minutes. Then you're going to run out.
I was just making the point, Candice. You don't go walking around in the desert. It's not safe. Like,
no.
These fucking morons. So anyhow, your dog bolts off. Fucking Bobby runs off after it like a moron. He chases it down, finds it gutted, just laying on the ground.
Oof.
It split open, fucking dead.
Oh, before that, he hears the dog yelping.
Yeah.
And it sounds like it's being ripped apart.
Yeah, and he's all like, oh, it's probably still okay. I guess I'll go around this corner and see what happened to it.
As a dog owner, just hearing those sounds, it's like a punch to the gut.
Yeah.
It's like, I know that panic, because when your dog yelps, you're like, oh God, are you okay?
Oh yeah, you're going, yeah. Doesn't matter.
Here's the thing, though. Let's say that dog really, really wanted to kill Bobby here, right?
Oh, he's like faking him out?
No. I'm just saying in a fight, if you put Bobby unarmed versus that dog, flat-footed, out here in the desert,
that dog's going to fucking win.
Right. Of course, so. Yeah. If you're Bobby, you're running in the desert, and you just heard something do that to the dog, whatever just did that to the dog is going to kill you.
That's true, but you don't care because that's your dog, man.
Oh, Tim,
you don't know me.
Hear
those stories about people who are like saving their dogs from sharks and like crocodiles and shit.
You will never hear that story about me.
Well, no, because you have cats.
No, because I'm smart.
No, because those fucking cats won't ride or die with you.
No, I have a cat.
Cats will eat your dead body.
Yeah, the cats will definitely eat you a lot faster than your dog will. If there's a fire, it's a lot easier to pick your dog up than to fucking pick your cat up in the fire. So
you know what, then? We have a fucking mutual respect for each other. How about that? That's more of a fucking peer than a dog.
You just look at your cat, you just let it go.
Yeah.
I trust you to get out of the situation. Goodbye.
Right. Yeah, if the house is on fire, the cat's not going to rescue me. It's going to look at me and be like, I got out.
Yeah,
that's true. You know what? If there was a cat in this movie instead of a dog at a certain point, that cat would figure a way to get out of that car from underneath and then just take off.
Yeah, yeah, the cat would just be out in the desert eating fucking moles and shit. He'd be fine.
So many times I thought, fucking cat wouldn't do that.
Yep. So anyhow, he sees dead dog, right? And he starts doing the panic. Woe is me, stumbles backwards, falls flat back down like a cliff. And I'm like, he's dead.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
it's quite the drop.
Yeah, there's a couple of things. The little problem I have with this movie, there's a couple of things where people should definitely be dead and they turn out not to be. But
so many times Doug gets knocked out.
He's got to break his leg at least something, right?
He's got to have severe brain damage. He probably forgot.
Well, are you talking about before or after the trip?
Yeah. Well, it's worse now.
Yeah. So he gets knocked out, and then a creepy little girl runs up in the red hoodie and starts fingering his head wound while he's sleeping. And we look up above, and there's just a dude eating a dog leg, like,
Yeah, straight through the fur, too.
Yeah, chewing right through the fur, man. And I've seen these guys' teeth. It doesn't look like they should be able to bite that hard. Yeah.
But it's an effective image.
It looks like a caterpillar.
Yeah. So, oh, God. Doug hits the end of the road, right? He gets to the end of the shortcut that's supposed to lead them to California. And there's just a big crater.
Oh, man.
So he looks down. He's like, hey, there's
fucking, you know what? I hate this fucking lib turd. Okay. I fucking hate this lib turd at this point.
Because he sees this crater with all of these abandoned vehicles in it. He's like, well, I should probably climb down there.
Let's go do some inspecting. I might find a fishing rod.
He can see that it's not just one crater. He's in front of a crater, but I think at this point he can see that there's many, many different craters around there.
I don't know that he can see it, but when we see him going down into the crater, then the camera zooms out. Yeah, and we see this is just where they've been testing nukes, right?
Yeah, like, it looks like the surface of the moon.
Yeah, don't go here. So we cut to Dad now. It's nighttime, and he made it to the station, right? So he comes marching into the station like he owns the place, looks around. He's like, hey, dude that works here, hello.
Yeah, I like how he opens that bottle of water up before he pays for it, where if he was a cop, he'd probably arrest somebody for doing that same thing.
Well, it depends upon their ethnicity, Tim.
He'd shoot them if they were black.
Right. That's a good point. Yeah. You guys ever do that? Ever open something in the store and start consuming it?
What?
You guys ever do that? You ever just shoot people in stores?
No. Oh, you ever just go in a store and be like, I'm thirsty, and crack open a Coke, drink it, and then pay for it?
Tim.
No, I'm trying to think. I might have done it like in a deli, but that's like as I'm on my way right to the cash register to pay for it. Not like I would walk in and pick something up and start drinking it, and then on my way out, put the empty bottle on the conveyor belt and go, oh, yeah, I had that.
Yeah. Whenever I see people doing that, I always think that they're psychotic.
Yeah, you cannot wait.
Yeah.
You cannot possibly wait the little bit of time it would take you to reach
the
address.
Maybe I got dry mouth, Candice, okay? Maybe I'm smoking Gorilla Glue 4.
Yeah, that's true. Okay, if you're high, then it's acceptable. That's fair. If you're higher, if it's like an ice cream cone and it's dripping, then all bets are off.
That's fair.
So now Dad goes
and just... You walk into a store and you can buy an ice cream cone in a supermarket?
Yeah, if you go to, Rite Aid? One of them, they have Thrifty's ice cream in there.
That sounds like cheap.
Thrifty's, yeah. That's
I bet it
Thanks a lot, Mom. I'd rather you forgot my birthday altogether.
Like those Thrifties. Fucking wooden spoon ice creams they give you in middle school.
Yeah.
Ooh, like these,
Thrifties, like these motherfuckers can afford Baskin but not Robbins. You know? You got like 31 flavors.
Keep
giving
that to you, kid. There'll be Robbins the store.
31 flavors. Now, we got 6. And 4 of them suck. So
they all taste like cardboard.
All different shades of vanilla.
No. Oh, my God. We started... They didn't have a good tub of our ice cream we usually get, the Tillamook brand, so I had to get the store brand. Fucking shitty ice cream sucks, man. God damn it.
Yeah.
It is very disappointing.
Just like,
see, I'm not very big into ice cream.
Really?
I like the ice cream you get from the Mr. Softy's truck, the one that's like got a bunch of fucking air puffed into it, and you can't buy that in a supermarket.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I hate and I miss? If like involving ice cream is nowhere in Missouri can you find New York Super Fudge Chunk from Ben and Jerry's.
Really?
That is the absolute best flavor of ice cream.
Where you live, Candice, nobody's even thinking about selling something from New York.
From New York.
That's true. Woke ice cream.
Oh, God. Yeah. Fucking shit. No, down there, it's all Bluebell, right?
Oh, there's a lot of Bluebell. Yep.
That's the brand.
What about Breyers? Is Breyers still a thing?
Yeah, you can find Breyers. They're all right.
They're the middle ground.
Wow. Haagen-Dazs, if you're going to get one and you have to get a chain, like, go for that.
Yeah,
that's fine.
Yeah, see, when I was growing up, it was always Breyers, and then Haagen-Dazs was like, oh, fuck, that's the rich people's ice cream.
Yeah, now that ain't shit. Haagen-Dazs I wipe my ass with nowadays.
Oh, no, what's that other one? Edie's?
Eddie's, yeah.
Is that Eddie? Oh, those fucking fruit bars, the lime and the pineapple ones?
Mm. Let's go get ice cream.
They sold it.
Yeah. No podcast. Shit. Shut up. You're making me hungry.
I saw something on the internet where there's an account I follow called I Was Today's Year Old. Where I found out about something, I guess. Mm-hmm. And it was if you take a fruit roll-up and you put it around ice cream, it freezes and becomes crunchy.
I mean, that's just science.
Yeah, I mean, I never knew that before. Plenty of times I've had fruit roll-ups. I never even thought to put it around ice cream.
Yeah, why would you think to do that?
Because you're high.
I'm high. I'm hungry. Yeah. I got the munchies, and I'm lazy. How can I eat two things at the same time?
So my big move is since what is it like February? I've lost maybe 16 pounds.
Damn,
yeah, nice. I lost 6 pounds in the last 3 weeks.
Yeah, look at you, Tim. Did you lose an arm or something?
no, I just stopped drinking beer and stopped drinking soda.
Yeah, yeah. So my move is...
Guys are like, I lost 20 pounds just by not drinking soda anymore.
Oh, my wife fucking hates me, yeah.
Oh, yeah, my wife pissed him.
She doesn't drink soda, so she can't stop drinking it to lose weight.
I got my wife an exercise bike. She's been riding it every night for over a year.
That's a bold, bold move, Eddie.
She wanted it, Tim. Okay. She's been riding it every night for a year, right? So I lose like 16 pounds. She's pissed because all I did was cut down on drinking. That was it.
Shit's difficult, man. Really no, fucking it's difficult. Not. Shut up.
I cut down on drinking and then I started, I'll do edibles at night and then I'll go grab a bunch of dark chocolate and dip it in peanut butter and eat it. And that's my diet.
Mm. Oh my God.
Oh, that and I don't eat before like 1 p.m.
That's just intermittent fasting. Eating
up I used to eat like around maybe 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock at night. Now I moved up a couple hours early. Yeah.
It's not intermittent, Candice. I do it every day.
No, that's not what intermittent fasting is. I'm not going to explain it. It's not riveting podcasting.
So Dad goes stomping around. He tries the phone. That doesn't work. He finds the bag of goodies. Opens out the guy's leftovers is what he has to assume that is. And that is rude. Mm-hmm. Don't ever fuck with a man's leftovers.
I thought it'd be funny if all the lights turned off and it goes into night vision mode.
Oh, God. Yeah. He gets stalked in night vision. Oh, man.
Puts the ear in the styrofoam.
Oh, they should have done that. That would have been so funny. But no, then he finds the newspaper.
He's like, if you do that, I'm walking off the set right now.
Yeah. Yep. Okay, we're going
to
put
fucking Monk for 12 years to get away from that shit. Come on.
Listen, we dug a hole in the basement of this place. We're going to lower you down into it. Now, we got that one of the dogs in a bucket. He's like,
we got a big dog
out
for you this time.
Yeah. So he finds all the newspaper clippings, and I guess he is able to put the story together.
Yes, I have that note, too. I was like, I would not have put that together.
That they're like,
does he put it together, though, or is he just looking at it? I think the only thing that he notices, really, that he's paying attention to is the missing the articles about the missing people.
Well, he puts together that they were set up.
Right, by this guy.
Yeah. So well, yeah, because he sees the fucking loot bag, yeah.
Now, either that or he saw his shadow, thought it was a black guy, because he pulls out his gun, is really what happens. And starts like.
Yo, and he's got a fucking Dirty Harry gun, too. This is a fucking six shooter from fucking hell.
Yep. I used to have a 357 mag revolver that was one of those. Oh, those are fun, man. Because if the barrel's long enough, you get a rifling action on it. So it's super fucking accurate. Mm-hmm. Fantastic
except
gun.
Except for that kick, yeah.
Well, I mean, you just hold the gun.
You just don't be a pussy, Tim.
Right. A 357 doesn't have that bad of a kick. Like, I don't know. Anyhow, so he goes out to the car, right? And he's like, all right, fuck this. I'm going to borrow this guy's car because I'm a white man. I'm entitled to it.
Yeah. And the keys are there, right? So it's you're not really stealing.
Well, because he does.
Fuck him because he set him up.
That's fair.
Where are you gonna like be like, oh, I need to be polite about this?
No. You know what? If I was him, I would have gone back and taken my money off the counter.
Exactly. Grab another fucking water.
You know what?
This is how we're paying for our vacation this year. Score.
I'm taking a couple of these little air fresheners too, you son of a bitch.
No, well, we should have seen. He should have been taking that fucking bag of loot out with him.
Oh yeah, no shit, dude.
You know, for evidence. I'll turn it in.
He's not going to wet his beak at all. No, so he goes to fire up the car. It won't start, but the headlights come on, and they're pointed at the outhouse. So he goes, heads out toward the shitter, and the dude's in there. You can see his feet, and he's just crying about, oh, there are kids in the mine. That's no place for the kids, man. I tried my best.
Yeah, that's after we put together from the precursor of the fucking newspaper clippings and stuff, is that there was a functioning mine there, but then they decided this was going to be where they were doing the nuclear testing.
Mm-hmm.
And so the miners refused to leave. And so they went into the mines, and the government said, fuck them, and started dropping atomic bombs on them. And there's that was like the 1940s, so there's like, what, three generations of mutant babies that have been breeding in the mines?
I would hope that at least if our government did something like that, because I'm sure the American government would never do something bad to its citizens for its own uses or anything like that.
No.
But at the very least, fucking cap those fucking mines with some concrete so these motherfuckers don't get out.
Yeah, right?
If you're gonna go that far, like, look, we're not sending the fucking army down to those goddamn things. No, fuck that shit. Count those fucking mines. Throw some fucking napalm in that shit, right?
Oh, just throw grenades down there and just shut it real quick.
Yeah. It's funny.
Problem solved.
Because it's like, on one hand, like, okay, yeah, our government sucks testing the nukes. The Cold War was a piece of shit, right? But on the other hand, they told them to leave because they were going to be nuking it.
Well, that was another thing that Aja said during an interview, was that he wanted the villains to be not entirely villainous, and he wanted the good guys to be not entirely good either. They're kind of paying for the sins of their fathers.
It's more realistic that way, too.
Plus, wouldn't the government be interested in finding out what happened to this family that lived in fucking mines where all these fucking nuclear bombs are going off?
See, this is... Okay,
well, that's why they showed the scientists in the beginning getting the fish, because they're like seeing the mutations from the environment or any effects.
Well, no, I just had the feeling they didn't know that they... No, because if they knew there was a family, there'd be people with guns. I think they're just testing the land for radiation and shit like that.
Yeah, I mean, say what you will about the Nazis, but they would have kept this family around and, like, tried to make super soldiers out of them.
Another sentence you never want to say is, say what you will about the...
I'm just saying, they would have been more pragmatic about their super mutants. You know, they wouldn't have necessarily just...
Isn't it funny how the son is the one who grows up to be the mutant?
Ah, yeah, true.
All the power true. Of... All
he
the
ends
power
up being pyro.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the dad goes over, old Bob, to check on the guys. Like, you okay, man? You need like a...
Are you sitting on the floor in a fucking outhouse shitter?
Yeah. And guy's got a shotgun, points it up at his face, and he's like, oh, I tried. And then he blows his fucking face off with a
shotgun.
It
is a good head explosion.
It's a great shot. Yeah.
Fantastic head explosion.
It's up there with Maniac.
And then you just hear creepy mutant voice saying daddy over and over again.
Oh, man, I came so hard.
Oh, man. So,
Candice, it excites you when somebody calls you daddy?
In a voice like that, yeah. But only that voice. It's very particular.
So he runs back into the car and he's like, fuck this, I'm going to get out of here in this car that doesn't start. And looks in the rear view. One of the guys is behind him, knocks his ass out, and then drags him into the minecart level in Donkey Kong.
Mm-hmm.
And while they're dragging him.
I don't remember there being people named Lizard staring at me when I was playing Donkey Kong.
Oh, yeah. That was Donkey Kong Country 2.
Oh, I never played that one.
Yeah. I played more of the first one, too. It was good. But I like that they're arguing about his gun. Like, you can't have his gun. Give that to me. I'm a man.
Which is another thing I love about this movie is the fact that these are smart mutants. They're mm-hmm. not just like dumb animals. Mm-hmm. They're not. They know what technology is. They know how to use it. They're not like, oh, what is this strange thing? Sniffing it, tossing it in the air. You know, like, it's a fucking gun. They know how to use it, too.
I would say they are smarter and more technologically adept than the woman in that hotel hell that Tim and I were talking about, who at one point claims she hasn't seen a television since 1993.
Yep.
West Virginia, just, ladies and gentlemen.
I call her bullshit
hair,
on that.
Her hair is so incredibly... Is I it, am an insane is, person hair.
Like, it's, is it like the giant blonde hair?
No, witch.
No, Candice, you have to watch it.
Witch.
And he put a picture of it in the Discord link.
No, okay. Don't tell him to do that, Tim. What is wrong with you?
Yeah, I'll put a picture up in the Discord. And you guys can look
God
at it.
God damn it.
So we go back to Bobby, right? Old Red scurries away as soon as his family members find his ass, right? Because he hears them screaming, he yells for him. They come, they find his ass. They take him back to the RV camp and start patching him up. And they're like, "Ah, don't worry about it. Your dog will come back soon. It'll be fine."
Okay, yes. Asshole.
Why doesn't he tell them?
Well, we find out later on why he doesn't tell him. And this is why I'm saying, what a little fucking asshole. So I don't upset the woman folk.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, my God. Ugh.
Somebody, it wasn't an animal, Mom and Dad. It couldn't have been an animal that did this. Somebody fucking split our dog wide open and took all its fucking innards out.
Plus, it's decapitated.
Yeah,
there was no head on that body. Animals don't do that.
Let me just come in and act all sporadic with a fucking gun after I've been concussed from falling off a fucking mountain.
Yeah, been unconscious for 4 hours.
Yeah, I just have, because I always try to go into these movies like it's my first time watching it again, you know? And so the notes I have is like, did he forget?
I do that with porn clips, yeah.
Did he forget that the dog was dead? Did he think it was a dream?
Yes, like, I have that note too. Did he forget?
What kind of cold monster is he that he's able to have the knowledge that this happened to his dog and then go back and act kind of normal, not be breaking down? Right.
So, Tim, you're on the Bobby is a sociopath tip.
A sociopath, fuck. That's why I call him a Kyle Rittenhouse.
Gotcha. So, yeah, then he grabs his gun and just starts, like you said, Tim, freaking out, like waving the gun around like an idiot.
Yeah. Well, not only that, but he did point it at one point when the father gives him the gun. The first thing he does is he points it at his fucking brother-in-law.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Points it directly at him. Don't worry, the safety is on. liberal Democrat from New York.
Mm-hmm.
You never point a gun at anybody, whether it's loaded or not, right?
Everybody knows this. Yeah. You don't have to be a gun person to know this.
Right, right. Liberal Democrat from Washington that loves guns. The first rule of guns is they're always loaded.
Oh, yeah.
The second rule of guns is there is no safety. And the third rule of guns is only pointed at something you want dead.
That's right. That's why don't point it at your dick.
Exactly.
For fucking his sister, because he couldn't.
Yeah. Yeah, what's up with that thing? Hold on. He was taking a piss. He thinks his sister was peeking at his fucking dick?
Yep.
I mean, you could say that they were ahead of their time with incest porn.
Mm-hmm. Oh, they're flipping the shit, because the brother gets the one who's stuck in the outhouse. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
He's stuck on fly paper. Is that a kink?
Hey,
I want to see that. Both your arms go forward, hit both the fly papers, and you're like, oh, no.
How would I don't think that stuck porn would work with the guy stuck in the outhouse. I think the laundry one, that works. The stuck under the bed one works.
Well, no, see, if it's a guy, you got to get it. He's stuck underneath the car while he's fixing it, right? See, the women do the laundry.
What?
So that's why they're getting stuck in the
oh, the yeah, because they have to be on their backs.
Yeah. Yeah, oh, Candice, that's right. And you got them on a little rocking board that can come out just a little bit, go back and forth.
Let's write this porno, Tim. We already got the whole premise set up.
Tim, you're giving Candice ideas.
Honey, go work on the car.
Hey,
why?
Honey, I think the car needs an oil change. Here.
Slowly the jack starts going down. Wait, I can't breathe. You can breathe a little bit, right?
Hey, while you're under there, take this pill real quick. I'm going to give you a medically hard dick while you're working on the car. I heard on Joe Rogan that makes you do a better job working on cars. It's having your dick hard while you're
doing it. Just in case your jack falls.
Yeah, the you got a new jack stand with your dick. Yeah, that's a good point, Tim. No, you've heard how, like, if a mother's kid is trapped under a car, She can like hulk up and lift the car up.
If I get horny, I can lift a car up. Yeah. Flip it over.
I was going to say, Tim sees the right redhead and he could lift that car up without his hands.
Just sit there smiling.
Go ahead and change the tire, baby.
Yeah. Hey, you know what? You want to do a rotation on all the wheels while I got this thing up here? It ain't going down for a minute. Nah, so, yeah. So he's waving his fucking piece around like an asshole. And he decides, yeah, I'm going to run out and I got to go, you know, kill all the mutants or whatever. Fucking idiot. Anyhow, he finally decides he's going to drop some intel on the dog. Right? Because, first he heads out with a gun. Their other dog broke loose, right?
And we don't get the return of the wimp, right?
Yeah. Doug returns, and he fucking damn near shoots Doug.
My God. And he's like, look at all this stuff I found. It's brand new.
He picks up a fucking teddy bear and dusts it off. He's going to give that to his fucking baby.
I just have Doug returns from the flea market, I guess. He's got like a baseball bat.
He's got a baseball bat. It looks like he's got a fishing pole, we find out later on.
And she's like, we're in the middle of the fucking desert. Why do you care about this fishing pole?
And he's got like some kind of like bag or something like that. It doesn't look like a tackle bag or something like that. It looks like a fucking like a thermos bag or something like that.
He's got one of those like tennis, like table tennis things with like the paddles and the ball.
Incredible, this fucking dickhead.
Yeah, he looks like Steve Martin from The Jerk.
Yeah. All I need is fishing pole.
Yeah.
So, as Jaws said in an interview with this character, he wanted him to be like Dustin Hoffman in Straw Dogs, where he's like super nerdy.
Gotcha. Yeah, I picked up on that right away. Yeah.
So, this was deliberate. Like, all the stupid shit that Doug does is deliberate.
Makes sense. Yeah. I mean, because you're building him, in a way, he kind of becomes like the anti-hero.
Well, everybody in this movie hates him. Everybody. Even his wife. His wife is fucking cocking him left and right.
Yeah,
his wife's she knows that the family's making
fun
of him.
Just humor him.
Yeah, and then she puts that fucking hat on him.
Yeah, that fucking hat. Jesus. Oh, man. Yeah, every turn, you're right. They're emasculating this man every turn.
Because doesn't the sister from Lost say something even at one point to her?
I think he was going to fuck the sister, by the way.
Oh man. She was laying outside in her like shorts and her bra. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and he was like staring at her.
Mm-hmm. See, this is why you wear sunglasses.
That's true.
They can't see you.
Oh, man. So I used to work at Subway, and I had the visor, you know? Mm-hmm. Didn't cover my eyes as far as I thought they did.
Oh, no.
So...
Hey, could you please look at my sandwich while you're making it instead of my sausage?
Drop dead, gorgeous guy walks in. Oh, I mean, he looks like a fucking supermodel. I've never seen a person like this before in person. Mm. You know, he like walks in and you take his order. I'm making a sandwich and I'm like sneaking glances at like his pecs and stuff.
Oh no.
And I think that my eyes are covered. And then when I check him out, mm-hmm. I give him his change back and I look up at his face and he's just like smirking, looking at me like he fucking knew the entire time.
Oh, God. And he's like, thanks for the extra beef.
Yeah. He comes in and you're all like, can I get a foot long? I mean, do you want a foot long? I mean.
Oh, so don't feel bad, guys. It happens to girls, too.
Oh, of course. So, what was Jared like, by the way?
Oh, man. I was trying to figure out a way to work Jared in.
He ate fresh that night, tell you that much.
See, the problem is that Jared was always trying to find a way to work Jared in, too, Tim. Mm. The only problem is he had his sights set a little low. So,
Jesus Christ.
By the way, do you think Subway tried to cover up his crimes like a Weinstein?
I do wonder if there's not at least one person in the company that did some covering up.
They're like, listen, I know he's fucking kids, but we need someone to push the sweet onion chicken teriyaki. It's not selling.
I just don't understand how you can be, I mean, because he's not super, super famous, like by today's standards, right? There's not social media around.
I mean, I would say he's infamous.
Yeah, well, I mean, no, but at that point, he was one of the most famous fucking people for that time, right?
Mm-hmm.
You had the TV, you saw that
as far as like spokesman for a sandwich shop, yeah.
Just how the fuck do you get away with that shit for so long? That's what I don't understand.
By the way, he was a terrible spokesman. He couldn't deliver a line.
I don't think he really did speak a lot. He just held out his fucking big ass fucking pants, right?
Yeah. He got fired from holding up pants because he was a pedophile. What a weird world we live in, man.
Unsafe.
Like that happened, and then the Noid thing, remember that?
You mean avoid the Noid?
Yeah. You know why they got rid of that?
No.
Oh,
don't say anything. Don't say anything.
No, the Noid
wasn't doing anything to little kids.
No. But there was a guy who was his last name Noid.
I think it was.
Something like, I think it was his last name was Noid. And he was of diminished mental capacity, let's say. So he thought that the marketing campaign was about him, and he killed somebody, like a Pizza Hut person or a Domino's worker over it.
That'd be fucked up if he killed a Pizza Hut guy.
He fucked it up.
I am the Noid.
He goes and kills Godfather.
See, that's what he
should have
done. Yes, he should have taken out fucking Domino's drivers.
Do you think he said avoid this before he shot the guy?
Damn it, I was going to use an avoid this joke. I was going to say when the delivery guy looked at the address and saw the name, he should have been like, nope.
Oh, like the Matrix, right? With Trinity. Avoid the annoyed this.
Oh, man. So, yeah, everybody tucked in for bed, though, because after Doug's jump scare, they're like, it's cool. We'll all go to bed.
Yo, what the fuck is up with this family?
Idiots. They've never
played. How the fuck is everybody going to sleep when the fucking father hasn't returned yet?
They've never played D&D, Tim.
They're very tired.
The first rule of D&D is if you guys set up a camp, you always take watch.
Okay, let me ask you something, Eddie.
Yeah.
So, you know, I watched the D&D movie again because it's one of my favorites.
Okay.
When they begin the movie, they're in a carriage. So, and I remember that when we played our little D&D, we started in a carriage. Do they always start in a carriage?
No.
Oh, just a coincidence?
No, it's, I was doing it as a reference to the theme of the game system itself. Ravenloft kind of starts that way. Plus, you know, a little take on the whole Skyrim thing. When you start off in the care. Anyhow. No, so you don't always.
Okay. Thank you for satisfying my curiosity.
Yeah, hey, no problem, buddy. So everybody's tucked in. All of a sudden, Bobby hears.
Oh, you're done with the D&D talk, right? Because I got up and I took a walk.
Yeah, you went where I go when fucking you guys start talking about Star Wars again.
To your happy place.
Yeah, just back in my brain. So, yeah, no, Bobby hears the dog. And he's like, oh, shit, the dog's out there. Pops open the camper, runs out. Because the other two, Doug and his lady friend, that sister, they decide they're going to sleep in the car.
In the truck. In have the a truck, little privacy. Yeah. They were
This kid is he's such a fucking asshole kid. All right? Because he comes back. He knows his fucking dog got fucking cut open. He doesn't say anything to the fucking women because he doesn't want to fucking scare them. He has this need to protect them without telling them why. He's just holding a fucking gun running around the camper.
Women are too weak.
Yeah. Then all of a sudden, he's like, yeah, fuck them bitches. I'm going out finding my dog.
Yeah, in the middle of the night.
Yeah. What the fuck is... He doesn't even have a flashlight because the kid's been fucking taking the flashlight, turning it on and off the whole fucking night while he's
flashing it in his mom's face while she's sleeping.
And fucking jumping around his fucking foot to make a vibration, too. Jesus Christ. I hate this fucking kid. Now that I even know who he is from fucking X-Men, I hate him even more.
Yeah, true.
But while that's all going on, I think it was the first boss from the game Rule of Rose, Rape Sloth from the Goonies.
What?
He pops into the van because he's going to try his riz on old Blondie, right? And fucking Bobby wakes up Doug and his other sister while Rape Sloth from the Goonies is got his hand over Blonde's mouth, like, you know, hold on,
man.
Be quiet.
Oh, yeah. Just that scene where she's just like sleeping peacefully And then you see this like mutant hand come in and like caress her hair and stuff. It's like, ugh, oh God. That's why I sleep with two big dogs. No one can do that shit.
Holy shit. Okay, so this movie came out the same year as Rule of Rose, the game on PlayStation 2. And what you play is a girl who gets chased by a guy who looks like Sloth from the Goonies trying to rape her.
Oh, I know that game.
And you have a best friend who's a dog.
You didn't say like Sloth from the Goonies. You just said it was Sloth from the Goonies.
Well, no, he's Rape Sloth. Not Sloth. Sloth never raped anybody. This is Rape Sloth. So... Bobby goes and wakes up Doug and his sister.
Gotta move a little faster than that, though, don't you?
And he's. That's true. You're going to need to be a little speedier.
At that point, you know, then I'm going to have to question.
Yeah, fair. If you could run away and you didn't. I mean, Tim's not one to victim blame, but.
I mean, it's a sloth. Come on.
Yeah. Moss grows on him, for Christ's sake. So he wakes him up and he's all like, there's people stalking us and they're going to fucking kill us. Get up. And the guy's like, what are you talking about, dickhead? And he's like,
information
okay.
That would have been good to know hours ago. Yeah.
He's like,
I didn't tell anybody about the dead dog because I didn't want to upset anybody. But boom, boom, boom. Wake up. Let's go, you libtard.
Wake up. My dog got cut in half and its head removed. And then I knocked myself out like a dickhead. And then
I'm pretty sure I saw a girl, a little Red Riding Hood.
Yeah. I had a head wound that got fingered. I'm missing my red sweater. I don't know what the fuck. Like
everything tastes red.
Yeah. nothing good is happening in this fucking desert. So, This is, it gives them the intel. They all pop up. And
so one question, do you think they were fucking in that car?
Oh, 100% they were.
Really?
Why do you think they were insistent?
I think this character, this guy would be like, no, you've had a rough day with the baby. You've been arguing. You're sweaty. You haven't had a chance to take a shower or bath. You're probably not feeling comfortable. Let's do it when we get to a hotel.
No. He's one of those quiet guys. Those are the freaks.
No, I think he was getting pegged.
Oh.
I think she got the strap on and she was fucking him right up his ass. I mean, because it was all fogged up in there.
It was very foggy on that window.
Yeah.
He had his glasses on.
A lot of heavy
off
breathing
too,
happening.
Mm hmm. Mm hmm. Plus, he was kind of
limping.
If
you're face down, you don't want your glasses on, right?
No, you don't want to bend them. Shit's expensive. No.
Yeah.
So the family's like, hey, what's that thing up on that hill over there that's just got lit on fire?
Oh
my God. This is the one of the worst parts of the movie, right?
Oh yeah.
This is
because the mutants, what they decided to do was they took the dad, right?
As a distraction.
And
they had this set up, okay? There was somebody waiting to do this, waiting for a call and a walkie-talkie.
And one of them gives him the call, and old Bob's all bundled up and they
shish kebab.
No, Tim.
Yeah. I get it.
Nope.
Come on.
I get him that.
Tim.
Come on.
Tim.
You're just pissed off because you didn't think about it like shish kebab.
No, Tim.
Yes.
Because these mutants have him all.
Oh, wait a
up.
Second. Wait a second. Bleep this out if this is too much. We're going to. Oh, no, no. No, sorry. Go ahead. No. I'm self editing myself right now.
Okay. What just happened?
I was going to say they have his ass tied up and they fire up the old barbecue.
Oh, God.
All right, listeners, tweet us who had a better one. Okay.
Shish kebab. He's not being skewered, Tim. It's a barbecue because they light his ass on fire alive.
You just sound like you're trying to do an Australian accent.
There you go.
Put another buffalo on the barbecue. Oh, man. So
your Australian listener is not going to get that joke.
Nope.
That's a buffalo.
They fire his ass up. And it is the worst CGI fire.
It
ain't great.
So bad. Because at one point, his eyes turn white because they burned his fucking irises out or something?
Yeah, that's what happens. It's one of the signs of death by fire is your eyes get that milky color.
Yeah.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, that's real.
All right. He starts to melt and then his shirt comes up and his skin is perfect underneath the shirt.
I mean, not for long.
Yeah. It's pretty rough.
If your face is melting, Everything is melting, right?
Well, they run over and get a fire extinguisher. And I love they're all running. Meanwhile, Doug's like, don't fucking go out there, dickhead. Mm-hmm. He's like, hold up. You don't know what's out there. Sensible. Right? Yep. You're being lured out there, idiots. Anyhow, another mutant pops down off the roof of the trailer, and he joins in on the rape fun.
Oh, man. This part, because it's extra horrifying. Not only is it a pretty explicit rape scene with this gross-ass mutant dude, but also her family's right there. Like, the people who could help her are right there, and they have no idea.
When Lip Turd runs into the fucking camper to get the fucking fire extinguisher, she's in there with the two dudes yelling and screaming a fucking head off. And
he doesn't hear it.
Yeah, he's like, what? I gotta go. I gotta go put your dad out. You know?
So maybe now he'll respect me.
So, yeah, then Blonde runs in there. Not Blonde. What's her name? God damn it. Brenda. Brenda runs in there. And because she hears, you know, the baby's in there. Clearly, got to check on the baby. So
also you see one of the mutants bite off a parrot's head. And then, squirt the blood into his mouth and stuff.
Like, you know, I'm not a bird person, but does a fucking bird have that much blood?
I don't know.
I don't think so.
Looks pretty good, though.
It looks pretty tasty.
Itchy tasty. But, no, this is one of the parts where the movie just really amps up.
Oh, it gets
this
rough.
This is what I have written down. Can't go too far.
Well, I mean, think of me at this time. 2006, I was only like 21. No, I can't do math. 2006? Yeah, 21. And I had never really seen a graphic rape scene in a movie before. And so I watched this movie and I was like, oh, fuck. I was like, this is unlike anything I have ever seen before.
Yeah, just fucking flicking it. She's getting all soupy down there.
Candice went, oh, fuck. I'm like, I wonder what how she originally said that.
Mm-hmm. Oh, fuck.
Oh, you were on that webcam. A 2006 webcam. Jesus Christ. Jesus,
damn. Back in the day.
Paying to watch Candice watch her first rape scene. Yeah.
We'll put that on the Patreon. Now, so... Yeah, fucking then Lizard pops in there. He's like, nah, man, you get the fuck off her. This is for a man to do, not you, boy. Mm-hmm. Kicks him off and he goes over slow bro, the sloth looking dude. He eats the bird, then here's the baby. He's like, oh, I'm gonna go check that out, right? That sounds like a lot of fun.
That's a new toy, yeah.
Yeah. So he's over there and the baby's like, you know, reaching at his head, and that's when Mom pops in. They catch with a mom and like, all right, here's the gun to the baby's head, Mom. Well, why don't you get over here and let's get them titties out.
Yeah, and there's some erotic lactation that happens.
Yeah, because he already drinks the milk out of the refrigerator. So yep. I guess he doesn't like the cold milk. He wants a warm one.
Yeah, he wants it fresh from the tap, Tim. It's always better that way.
Yeah, he's like breastfeeding from the mom while he's holding a gun to the baby's head.
And then
how
grandma,
fucking great is this movie?
Can a movie go too far?
And then grandma comes in and is like, what the fuck?
Well, no, she picks up a gigantic fucking rock before she even goes in.
Yeah, to brain the dude with. That works out real well for old Ma because she gets fucking shot.
Yep.
It's the men of the hunters, and she's the gatherer of stones, right? Mm-hmm. It keeps spinning,
Brenda grabs the fucking screwdriver and just starts stabbing the shit out of dude in his fucking leg with it.
That was pretty boss.
Good move.
No, here's a problem I have with this, is because I've never been stabbed in the leg, but if I got stabbed in the leg, it would not make my arm with the gun go down in slow motion.
Yeah, that's true.
Because it looks like it hurts to move his arm down to blow her fucking head off. Oh, spoiler alert.
Yeah. Well, what are you going to do, though? You know? Don't have too many options. I mean, unless you could, like, will your milk to poison or something.
That's why you're not supposed to stress out the women.
Well, wait a second. Because it sours the milk. Desert. Yeah. She's been in the desert, so that's a lot of heat.
True. It could be curdled in there. He could be getting some yogurt
out. Make your lip sizzle.
Got yogurt coming out.
It's refreshing yogurt drink in the desert. Ugh. So, but then I just have they grab the baby and run off with it. But before they go, he whips the gun around, shoots her in the fucking head.
Yeah, this made my wife jump. She was shocked because she was convinced that this was going to be the fucking final girl.
Yeah, because you're not going to kill the mom of the baby.
Yeah.
That'd be insane, right?
Turns out you do, kind of. But I do love that they let her live long enough for Doug to run in and comfort her for a sec, just as she kind of like half-brained up.
Oh, she's not dead. That's bullshit. But I'm happy. And they're like, oh, wait. Hold on.
And she kind of gurgles for a minute.
Because, because my wife is Korean, sometimes there's a little bit of a language barrier. So sometimes she'll have to send me something and I'll have to translate it. And I looked at it in Korean and said, can movies go too far?
Oh, wow. Amazing. It's AI. Yeah. AI watched this movie and said, can movies go too far?
What happened to the AI write-up, you fucking scab?
The AI write-up. You know what? I don't have a good AI for this one. That's a good one. You know what? I'll fire it up. We'll get its thoughts at the end. How about that?
Okay, that sounds good.
Yeah, there we go. It can wrap on it for us. So I just have that
old mom. Have it listen to our show and then give us a review and see what it says.
No.
Can you do that?
No, I can't. So old mom, she's also not dead yet.
Nope, she's still gasping on the couch.
Yeah. So Doug tucks her in. She got shot
right in the flag.
Yeah, true.
Literally, they shoot her right in the flag on her shirt.
Well, being a little heavy-handed, I guess. So she's laying there, though, and she's all like, oh, Doug, is everything cool? And he's like, yeah, everything's cool. Don't worry. Bob, he'll be here soon. He'll be all right. She's like, oh, that's nice. I'm a little bit cold, so why don't you cover me up? And he does, and she fucking dies. So then we zoom out.
Say, do me a favor. Be a man.
At this point, the dad, the mom, who were celebrating their silver anniversary, by the way, mentioned in the beginning of the movie, and the mother of the baby are all dead.
Yeah. So we're left with... most of Bobby.
Sister. The Kyle Rittenhouse.
Yeah. Kyle Rittenhouse is left. The libtard's left. And the sister that he wanted to fuck more anyway is left.
Well, I mean, she is Bill. Well,
there's your inn right there, right? You've gone Bill through a tragedy together.
She's Belle. The dogs are named Beauty and the Beast. That's funny.
That gets brought up.
Holy shit. That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. So it zooms out, though, and one of them is spying on the camp through binoculars, right? And he just kind of puts the binoculars down.
Is this the motherfucker in the bowler hat?
Yes. Yeah, he is the motherfucker that gets his
looks
throat.
Looks like Snape from fucking Harry Potter, even though I've never seen the movie. I've just seen enough of the commercials to know that that's what the guy looks like.
No, he looks like Voldemort from Harry Potter, close not enough. Snape. Snape's just Alan Rickman.
That's Ray Fiennes.
No, Snape is just Alan Rickman, Tim.
Yeah, Alan Rickman's Snape, and Fiennes is Voldemort.
Right. See, Voldemort's the big bad guy. Snape is just the hard-ass teacher.
Okay. Who's the real hero?
Whatever.
Yeah, because he fucks. So, then
not Harry Potter's mom, though.
Yeah. Yeah, so then I just have Beast rips the throat out of this fucking dude.
Oh, man, Beast for the win. Beast is the real hero of this movie is Beast.
Yeah, the dog get the fucking payback in this movie.
The dog is the only one with a positive KD ratio in this fucking movie.
The dog is the at only one point, that's effective.
Yeah. Well, hold on. At this point, the dad is dead, right?
Yeah,
His dog is now the alpha of the family.
That's true.
Yeah, because it's between the Bobby and Doug.
Man. I just thought about the sister and what the dog would be doing with the sister. Establishing dominance over the brother.
And the brother, too, right? Just to really drive that point home. Come on.
So you're saying the dog's banging out the sister and making them watch.
Exactly.
You can have it after I'm done. I'm the alpha here. He's got prima noctis on him.
But I call first.
Yeah. So Doug and the dog, they follow the bloody trail to a mine entrance. Right? And it's now morning. And as he goes in there, we see a bunch of minor graves.
Bad move, right? This is bad planning. You don't put your fucking cemetery right at the entrance.
Oh, is this the point where they get the walkie-talkies?
Yeah, this is when
the my God, again, they fuck up the whole thing. They can hear everything that the fucking bad guys are planning. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then they keep talking on it so the bad guys can hear what they're fucking doing. I'm going in right now. Okay. Yeah.
Whatever you do, don't tell them over their walkie-talkies. Mm. By the way, the walkie-talkies just attached to an arm.
By the way,
the dog ripped off of
you think they're registered to vote Democrat? Because I got a petition I have on the side.
Oh, not lizard. It's goggles. Goggles is the one that the dog takes out.
Yeah. And then I guess it drags the arm. Coming up is Google.
Yeah. So I guess we're supposed to believe then that the dog killed Goggles and then like brought the arm with the walkie to the camp.
Is that
like,
where the fucking arm came from? Yeah, oh, Tim. Fuck. Because I saw that. I was like, wait, did the dad have a fucking... No.
Nope.
Where the fuck did the walkie-talkie arm come from?
No. Goggles.
So he walks through the cemetery in the mine entrance, goes through that, finds Nuketown from Black Ops 3.
Who took those pictures, by the way?
Oh, of the miners?
Well, yeah, because all the fucking gravestones have a picture on it. I'm like, who took those pictures?
I thought it was like family that already had pictures and just put them on there.
If it's somebody who's famous for taking a bunch of pictures of miners, I'd say Subway Jared.
Oh, my fucking God. Eddie, stop doing that shit, man.
What, making fun of him?
No, because you got two great fucking jokes off in a row every week.
I'll slow down, Tim. Sorry about that.
Who's taking pictures of minors? Holy fuck.
That's why we're number one, baby.
So, yeah, and back at the camp, I just have Brenda decided to burn a tire. And I'm like, what? Wait a minute. Hold on.
Yeah, well, they did this on Lost, so that's where she got the idea from.
Okay. She went back in time from Lost. Oh, God. Wait, was Lost before this or after?
This is after. Lost might still be on, or it might have just ended, because I remember when I saw it, I was like, that's a chick from Lost.
Yeah. So she's burning the tire to be like a smoke signal, because, you know, somebody will see black smoke and be like, oh, it's definitely not the fucking mutants killing and eating people. And they'll come,
using the radios and stuff reminded me of something that happened when I was young. Uh-oh. I was probably like 11, 12 years old. And of course, I lived in the Appalachian Mountains, and radios, like, would pick up just very intermittently. Like, radio signals would get blocked all the time because of the mountains.
Yeah.
So I was, like, channel surfing in the car when my dad was driving, trying to find a signal that wasn't blocked. And all of a sudden, I hear this woman, like, kind of crying a little bit. And then she goes, someone, please help us. And then she's, like, giving her location. And it's like, someone, please help us. And then, like, I lost the signal. And it faded out again. And I looked at my dad and I was like, should we do something about that? And he goes, nah. Like,
yeah, knock the bitch out in the trunk. Get her off the fucking radio.
You know, he was like, nah, it's probably like a radio station or something.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, okay. And like, ever since then, I've always wondered, was that an actual person trying to ask for help?
She's dead, Candace.
Like, it was
either way,
it was
she's
so
dead.
Creepy.
Yeah.
You know what? You might have been the last person to hear her alive.
Oh God, don't say that.
You ever think about that?
Put some Van Halen on.
Her cries for help might have just echoed off of you.
Yep. And landed on deaf ears.
Wait, is it a CB radio or a regular radio?
It's just a regular radio.
That's bullshit then. Your dad's right. Because who the fuck... That lady got whatever happened. She got to a fucking radio station with fucking 50,000 watts broadcasting in the fucking mountains of Appalachia.
Yeah, no. Tim, you're right. She was probably just getting baloney thrown at her ass by Howard Stern. She was whining about
Guys, did you hear that he's sexist?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God. I can't believe that. Because I remember, when I listened to the CD that I had to send away with a fucking check of a crucified by the FCC, I was shocked. I got called out for crazy shit.
They found a clip of him from 1985, back when they were still advertising fucking cigarettes that had uranium in them, where he called a woman sweetie or something. So we should definitely go kill him.
Yeah, we should cancel him for being so misogynistic.
He's already can't. Yeah. Okay, then he's going to retire.
Look, I will be fair, because the one thing I think I have on both of you is I grew up with Howard Stern.
Nope, same.
From ABC radio all the way over to FM radio, all that stuff is, mm-hmm. He really doesn't have too much of a leg to stand on saying shit about people.
No.
With what he did back then, he's got a pass for it. Okay, look, different time. All right, yeah. But he really can't say, oh, this person's crazy or this is going on and shit like that's too much because of the shit that he did back in the day.
Mm-hmm.
Back then, people saying all the shit that he's saying now about some people. So. Well,
is he saying things that about other people being misogynistic or something?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, oh. He went like hard against Trump for the longest time.
And there's lots of things he can go about Trump. But, you know, when you're Howard Stern, there's certain things you can't be saying, right?
Yeah, the sexism stuff. Remember when he had that guy bring his dead daughter that he stuffed in? You remember that, Tim?
I want to say no, but I vaguely, that strikes a bell with me, but.
Yeah, this guy stuffed his dead daughter and then his wife divorced him over it and he brought her in.
Was that in the 90s?
Yeah.
Or the early 2000s? Because you just, for some reason, that made me think of a Jerry Springer episode I watched where it had amputees whose spouses were cheating on them with other amputees.
What?
Exactly.
Dude, well, that's what happens to those fucking support groups, man.
And I was like, the fucking 90s and early 2000s, man.
Yeah.
That was some insane shit that we were watching on TV.
This is why I gotta find like all of those old reality shows and shit and start putting them up on the bank, man. Because it's some of the best entertainment we've ever had. You know?
It was a special time. Yes.
It was. And not in the sense that it's fun to laugh at those people, but like the fact that they just put their ass on television. You know what I mean? Like, it's insane.
Some of those people, it's okay to laugh at.
Yeah.
And it was the very beginning of when reality TV was really hitting, too.
Yep. Yep.
And people didn't know what to do or think of it or make of it. And so they were just throwing everything out there.
And by the way, don't message me and tell me that it wasn't a real dead girl that the guy brought in. I know it was a bit, but the point is they were playing it as real. So, yeah. Anyhow. Dude's sneaking around, right? And he finds he hears a generator, right? So he's like, oh, shit, they got electricity here? Okay. Heads over to that house. He hears the baby crying, right? The dog starts responding. And he's like, oh, shit, this dog is going to blow my stealth. So he locks the dog in this road warrior car that he finds where they've, like, put mattress springs up for the windows and shit.
Yeah, it's real ghetto.
It reminded me of in Florida, the guy that was missing his driver's side door, so he put a baby gate up in his car and was on the freeway. Yeah, so that's why I just have in my notes, like, I guess this is in Florida now. So, he sneaks in for the baby, gets knocked out by this big bald broad who's, like, brushing this baby doll's hair. And watching TV.
Watching Divorce Court.
Yeah. Was that on, like, do you think they get a broadcast signal out there, Tim? Or does she have cable?
Oh, do you think she has, like, VHS tapes of people recording episodes of Divorce Court?
Just Divorce Court?
Yeah.
Oh, God. So somebody was, like, driving cross country with their collection of Divorce Court VHS tapes.
You never know what you're going to find in those trucks.
Fair. Yeah. It's either that or it's like those educational videos. Get
some edutainment.
Yep. Yep. That or like a subway training video. You know?
So the grind edutainment,
is that when you
basically,
like, watch porn, but you don't come for a long time?
Yeah, Tim.
Oh, Tim.
That's very good, Tim.
So, I came in cold and I picked that up, huh?
That's good, Tim. Oh, man. So he gets fucking knocked out by this bald broad. And they just stuff him in this dirty-ass drop-in freezer. Mm-hmm. That
I have written down, a vegan's worst nightmare.
Oh, yeah. To be stuck in the meat department. That's a good point.
Could you imagine how bad that thing stinks, too?
That's what I had. I said, why did he need to turn the light on to know he was in rotten meat?
It's one of those things like where you cut your yourself and you don't notice it until you see it and then it hurts.
Yeah. It could be. Yeah. Like a paper cut, one of those. Oh, God.
Let me ask you guys a question. How long do you think you would live in the Nevada desert by yourself? How far do you think you'd make it?
Wait, like naked and afraid make it?
Yeah. I mean, you'd have clothes on. You'd have everything that this dude has.
I'd just be afraid. Okay.
Yeah. So you would have a, what did he steal from the place? He had a fishing pole.
Okay. Yeah. So that's good for when you come across a mirage and you think you see an oasis.
Yeah. Tim, how long do you think you'd survive in the desert?
Give myself maybe 2.5-3 days. Because how long can you last without water?
Three days.
Yeah. Especially in that heat. Is it even 3 days anymore? Is it down to like a day and a half?
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. What's the rules? 3 days without water, 3 weeks without food.
3 weeks without food, yeah.
And 3 months without pussy.
Yeah, that's the saying.
Yeah.
I'm in a pussy desert.
Is that like a food desert? We have in the Midwest? Yeah.
It's like you move to San Francisco and it's like
there's
a food
desert.
There's
just no affordable pussy around.
Oh, God. What about you, Candice? How long do you think you can make it in the desert?
You know, I've done a lot of hiking in the Appalachian Mountains.
Okay.
So I feel like in the Appalachian Mountains and like in the Midwest, I'd probably last a pretty long time.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be living the high on the hog or anything like that, but I'd survive. But in the desert.
What would you be eating?
Oh, there's lots of food that you can dig up around here if you know what plants to look for. And I do, because I looked it up.
Yeah, in the Appalachian. Yeah, sure. The desert.
Are you eating grubs? What?
But in the desert, I'm like, I don't think I'd last very long. Maybe dehydration would be the thing that would get me.
Yeah. I think I'm with you guys. I think about a day, and then I'd find my way out.
Or you just pass
out. No, I'd just leave. I'd be like, fuck this. Yeah.
You would just walk out of the desert?
Yeah. Why would you stick around?
You are truly our savior, Eddie.
Why didn't anybody else think of that? Just leave.
You idiots are staying. I'd just leave.
By the way, listeners, we're starting a cult. You're welcome to join.
Yeah. If you want to join our cult, just go to the Discord and you can see Jar Jar's asshole.
That's initiation. One of the first tenets.
If you make it past that, you'll take anything.
That's a good point, man. If you can make it past our Discord, you're good.
No, Discord's nice.
Yeah. So
we're not trading government secrets in our Discord. So.
No. He busts out of the drop-in freezer, snags the bat, right? Walks around, and he hears somebody singing the Star Spangled.
First time he's had something hard in his hands in how long?
Well, I mean, he was probably helping her with the strap on last night, so.
She makes him put it on.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. He's the one who has to buckle it in the back, or however you put those things on.
I like that. That's a power move.
What if he makes him wear a strap on when he fucks her? That's like the ultimate cucking, right? Look, you don't even get to fuck me.
Isn't that how you DP?
Yeah, yeah. With a strap on.
Well,
I don't know.
Good to know.
I've been doing it wrong all these years. You could do it that way. What else? You could go buy a horseshoe. That'll work.
A horseshoe? how big is this chick's chode?
Maybe a tuning fork then, if you're...
Tuning fork, I like.
Particularly
small. I like that thing.
Cocktail shrimp forks.
That's the female version of sounding, Tim. You shove stuff a tuning fork in their ass and their pussy, and you smack it.
There you go.
Hey, sweetheart, can I give you a tune-up?
Yeah, because you got a flat A. Or A flat, I guess.
How are we not more popular?
I think because of this. I think
we
this is.
Found. That's what it is.
I've listened to other horror podcasts. They tend to be serious about things and take less than 3 hours. So.
We need to be sponsored by more than just remakes.
Yeah, we need something. Get Andrew Tate on next month. If we get Andrew Tate on, we'll get more popular, Tim.
I pass. That's okay.
I had a note in here that I think one of these people was listening to an Andrew Tate podcast. The guy, the brain guy. I just every time I picture like one of those Andrew Tate guys or one of those Charles Kirk.
That's
or,
what you imagine.
I just imagine Brain Guy singing the Star Spangled Banner.
Oh, you mean the head of the family? Baby. That's the head of the family. What are you talking about?
Yeah, the head of the family. Exactly, Tim. And so he's like, where the fuck is the baby? The guy's like, I don't know. I don't really get out of this chair a lot.
He's like, I never leave.
It's like, oh, okay, gotcha. Then he just starts blaming him. He's like, you guys did this. You dropped the fucking bombs on us. And I'm like, you sound like every dickhead that won't move from Tornado Alley.
Oh, yeah.
Just leave.
This is my land. I was born here. I'll die here. It's like, well, you're going to die.
Yeah.
So I hope you enjoy
it. At a certain point, it's your fault. I'm sorry.
It's literally just land. It's not your life.
Your brain has grown into the chair. Like, you're done, dude. So he starts giggling. He's like, well, what are you laughing about, dickhead? And he's like, oh, it's breakfast time. And that's when Sloth shows up from behind. Oh.
When you see that one of his eyes is gone and it's just oozing pus.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, it's so gross.
That's not sustainable. You can't be oozing that much pus for that long, right?
Well, maybe all the activity makes it burst.
Oh.
Could be, yeah. Stressed him out.
My question is, between this and Texas Chainsaw Massacre and a bunch of other movies like this is, you know, these motherfuckers destroy their fucking house all willy-nilly. And then who comes and fixes this shit?
They do. They're salt of the earth people.
Yeah. Yeah. I feel like they just probably would move into another one of the houses in the nuke town.
True. Okay.
It's kind of like that episode of The Simpsons where they just moved the entire town 10 miles down the road. Yeah. That's one of the best Simpsons, by the way, where Homer's the garbage commissioner.
Can't somebody else do it?
Yeah. What a fantastic show that used to be. God damn it.
Used to be. Gee, I swear to you, I probably haven't watched that show in as long as it's been on. And half the time it's been on.
Yeah, that's fair.
I stopped around maybe 15 seasons in.
So yeah, he just starts like fucking juggernauting through the house.
Oh, yeah. Beating the shit out of Doug.
Oh, yeah. Doug gets fucking wrecked, man.
Also, cuts off a couple of his fingers.
Dude, with the axe? Oh, my God. Yeah, because he hides under the table, busts the table up. Dude hides in the bathroom, and he wheels that big tub to block the bathroom door.
Put the tub the wrong way, my friend. Put it lengthways, not sideways.
Yeah. It doesn't matter, though, because dude just Kool-Aids through the fucking wall and choke slams him.
Yeah,
as soon as the camera went over to the wall, I was like, he's coming through the wall.
Yeah.
Yeah, all I could think about was Resident Evil 7.
Yes.
When the Papa Baker, can't remember his name, he like burst through the wall. Because you're like, I'm sneaking down this hallway, I can get past him. Boom! Burst through the wall right in front of you.
Fuck, and Resident Evil 7 is good.
That is pants-shittingly terrifying.
Yeah.
Is that the way he chases around the fuck? Yeah, you gotta run in between the fucking wall, broken wall. Yep. Yeah,
doing that in VR.
I would piss myself.
Oh, fuck you
I would
up,
die.
Man.
I play Phasmophobia, and I'm yelling for my husband to help me. He's like, what the fuck do you want me to do about it? I'm like, don't leave me alone.
Just stay in the room. Oh, my God. My poor wife. I got her that game Dredge on Switch.
Oh, yeah.
She started it, and she's to the point where it's like, okay, you need to get in the ship and go out fishing at night, because it's like a Lovecraftian horror.
Yeah, it seems game. Like a spirit fair or whatever it's called, but with like Lovecraft horror elements to
right,
it.
Right, but evil. And so now she's like, I can't play it. It's too scary for me.
It's too scary.
Well, yeah, she loves those horror games, but she'd never play them. She'd always make her friends play them or somebody else play them while she sat there and watched.
There's something about playing a video game in the horror that it hits so much harder than ever watching a movie could do.
Yeah.
Like I played Slender the Arrival, and I thought I was going to die. Like, it scared the shit out of me.
To this day, I will never forget when those fucking dopamines came busting through that fucking window in Resident Evil.
Oh,
that's
God.
A classic. Yep.
And I think what it is it's because in a video game, you have to take action to progress the story. So as a function of the gameplay, it's a fear of taking action is like a central gameplay element. You know what I mean? Like, just not wanting to go around the corner or go into the room. That's why I like Junji Ito's books so much, because he plays with that. He'll have, like, two pages, you know, that are just fine, but they're kind of building and building. You get to the last cell on the last page and you're like, I don't want to fucking turn this because this dickhead is going to have a fold out on the next page of some horrific shit
that you know. Never want to see.
Right, right. So I think it has that same kind of a connection between the medium and the atmosphere, which you can't really do in movies as well.
Yeah. Yeah, so, especially yeah. But hey, isn't horror great?
It really
Look
is.
Look at all these permutations about it we just talked about. It's a beautiful thing.
Yeah. Across different genres, different mediums, it's fantastic. So, yeah, Doug, though, he starts fucking manning up a little bit in this shit. He tussles with him, gets up, right? Stabs him in the gut with this busted baseball bat, right? But then dude pulls it out. Beans him across the head with
just
it.
Laughs at him,
spears him through the wall like fucking Goldberg. Just
because this dude's huge.
Yeah, then just picks him up and tosses him like a doll through a window. Just flink, like get out of here. You're bothering me. So dude whips out his screwdriver. Thug does,
and he's so beat up. You can tell that he is barely conscious at this moment.
Yeah, he is like just sucking in air. Just
this is like Alabama in a final standoff in a True Romance.
Oh God, you know what, Tim? You reminded me. I've been meaning to rewatch True Romance again.
Oh man, it's so good.
Fuck, it's a good
so
movie.
Good, yeah.
It's one of my
favorite Tarantino movies, even though he only wrote it.
Yeah, I got a double feature True Romance and Eastern Promises one of these weekends.
Mm. Oh, that's definitely white boy day.
Really feel like killing yourself.
Yeah, dude, they're fun. Come on, man. Some of the best action. Oh, damn. Anyhow, he sees him. The mutant looks down at him with the fucking screwdriver and just like, what? Thinks it's funny, right? So he's laughing at the guy, and the guy just like, now talk about not only emasculated, but he whips out his little pussy ass screwdriver of a weapon, like his tiny dick.
And everybody's this is when laughing. He takes the turn.
Everybody's laughing at his dick. And then, Tim, you thought the other dude was Rittenhouse. Well, once they laugh at this guy's dick, he takes that turn. Screwdriver through the foot, right? Then grabs the flag, one of the flags that they stole, and rams it through the dude's fucking throat.
And he pulled it out of the dad's body.
Yeah, mm-hmm. out of the dead dad's head. So, goddamn. Then he picks up the dude's axe straight to the fucking dome. And then the big guy falls over dead. And in the background, you just see Brain Guy. Like,
he's
watching.
Like, oh, shit.
Yeah, it's like, fuck. But
breakfast is done.
I guess he's not sticking around for lunch because he picks up his busted glasses, puts it on. Like, okay, now it's our hero. He's covered in blood. He's got the glasses on. He's ready to go.
He's got his first taste of blood. He knows what it is to be a man now. He's taking a life.
Yeah, right? The second one's always easier.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So he just leaves Brain Guy, though. He's like, all right, fuck this guy. I'm out of here. He's not going to hurt me. I got to go find my baby, right? Just on his way out, just in passing, like you said, second one's always easier. He just glancing blow with the axe to the knee of dude in traction.
Of Greg Nicotero.
Yeah, of Greg Nicotero. Takes that and then one to the back, punk, flips him over.
Oh, man. And then flips the axe over.
Spike
to the pointy end.
Of the axe through the head. Just like a bolt gun to a fucking cattle's brain, man.
You're gonna tell me this movie isn't great.
Oh, it's fantastic.
It's a good movie. Nobody's saying it's bad.
Yeah, yeah. I don't think I've ever said this was bad. I hate the family.
Oh yeah.
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 At a certain point, I'm like, you know what? I wish another nuclear bomb would go off and just kill everybody.
Oh God, yeah. If another nuke just went off right now.
Oh, wouldn't that be great if like there's a cutaway scene and it goes to like the Pentagon and like it's happening again. I'm like, okay, call in the fucking F-16.
Yeah.
And they just nuked the fucking thing like Night of the Living Dead, Return of the Living Dead 2?
Jesus. Be fucking great. Yeah. Just because the gas is out. You know what? Some of these guys kind of look like the fucking mutant zombie assholes. So anyhow, he takes that dude in traction out. Takes out Nicotero, right? Then he hears old brain dude in the background pick up his radio, and he's like, "Oh, lizard, kill the baby," right? Why?
And then Beast shows up.
Mm-hmm. Why kill the baby? Why?
Just to be spiteful.
This is a bad move. Let the guy get out of fucking hearing range before you say it, right?
Yeah, or just kill the baby to begin with.
Yeah. I mean, I guess they were just wanting some fresh blood.
Yeah, I suppose. That makes sense.
Well, how are you keeping this thing going, right?
Dude, and then, like, the fact that Beast just walks in and looks at Brain Guy. And he's like, hey, lunch.
Hey, we needed more of this scene, right? It's the unrated cut. Let this fucking dog go crazy on this guy's balls.
I'm kind of with you, Tim. It's fun to not see it, you know, and just leave it in your brain like, what the fuck?
Yeah, you hear like screaming.
After you see John Wick, you really want to see it again, so.
Yeah. Just because, like, you know that guy's probably squishy, you know?
Oh, yeah, so it's really tearing in.
Shit.
So that dog, there's no muscle. That guy doesn't stand up. This guy's like veal.
Yeah, he's just organs.
Yeah, just
like
organs.
Just scratch him and his fucking skin breaks open.
Yeah. Oh, man, that had to be a nice little treat for Beast.
Oh, yeah.
No, I'm betting that dog's at the very least got shits.
Yeah, you think so? You got the shits from them?
Mutant turds.
Eating irradiated meat.
That glow in the dark, maybe. Yeah.
Yeah. Good point.
Like so Aqua Teen Hunger Force, glow in the dark mutant turds.
Yeah, from the, what was the machine that was making his dick bigger?
But it was irradiating his nuts in his ass.
He was just shitting out like uranium bricks.
It was like eating through the ground.
God, I love that show. I can't wait for the movie to come out, man. They're doing another one.
Oh, it's going to be great.
So good. That and Venture Brothers.
I love Venture Brothers. I love Venture Brothers.
Yeah, that was one of the first things my wife and I watched together when we were first getting together.
Aw.
Yeah.
That's like the golden age of Adult Swim.
It really is. Yep. Yeah.
C-Lab.
C-Lab was fantastic. Yeah. It's funny, I was going to reference C-Lab, actually, in this movie. But
did you see labia? No, I'm just kidding.
No. No. So we cut to Red with the baby, right? The little girl with the Ruby is what they call her. And she's hanging out, taking care of the baby. Yeah?
Ruby the Attila.
Yeah, the Attila, right. And Lizard comes in. He's like, all right, I got to kill the baby. And so Ruby's like, no, don't fucking do that. And he's like, well, get the hell out of here. Yeah, I'm going to fuck you up too. So she's like, fine, leaves.
Where did Ruby come from?
Well, she just kind of hangs around.
Yeah.
We don't see any of the women.
Everyone really ignores her.
Well, there's bald woman.
I assume the bald woman is the mom of Ruby.
It's got to be, right?
Yeah, because it's the only other woman.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Which is why they keep raping everyone.
I mean, I guess we're assuming the genders of, like, Goggles and...
No, that's fair.
And Cyst or Puss or whatever his name was.
It's Cyst.
Yeah.
God. That reminds me.
He's a Cyst? Okay. Yeah. Gotcha.
That reminds me, in the sequel, there's even more monster rape in it. And my husband grossed me the fuck out because he was like, that's what Bowser does to Princess Peach.
Oh,
just
yeah.
Slant, make me baby.
One day it'll come out right.
And that's where all the little Koopa kids came from.
Exactly. Mm.
So, she leaves, and he goes to go under the blanket to take out the baby. But no, it's a pig. She hid a little pig under there. And Ruby took the baby. So she runs off with it. Doug hears them leaving and looks up and sees her up in the hills. So we cut back to the camp for a minute.
She's right on the ridge line. She's got to be smart enough to know that she needs to, like, not be on top of the ridge.
Well, she's camouflaged in that bright red hoodie.
Yeah, exactly, right?
Fucking idiot, yeah.
Well, the dad is like, Doug is trying to find the baby, and he's stumbling through all the houses, and then he comes across this, like, nursery with these two, like, mutant kids in it.
Oh, God, yeah.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I was like, how funny would it be if he killed those kids?
by the way, those two kids
just murders them.
That would be funny. But by the way, those two kids, Tim, they grew up to be Prussian Blue, the two little Nazi girls that sang all those songs.
What?
You don't remember that?
No.
Prussian Blue? Never mind. Before Trump, there were Nazis in America, and these two little girls were basically like, I think their parents were like Klan people, and there were these two blonde little twin girls that they made sing like Nazi shit. But I think they got out of it.
Here's my question. If their parents are such diehard Nazis, why didn't they donate their fucking twins for medical experiments?
Yeah, exactly. Why weren't they injecting hot chocolate into their fucking brainstem to see if they dreamed about eyeballs. Christmas? Yeah. Let's put semen in their eyeballs. See if they make eye babies. Just fucking Mengele. It must have been nice to be a scientist back then. Because it was just like, I wonder how long it would take to boil a guy to death. And then that was science.
You don't know how much I've thought about that.
Yeah. You would have done well in Japan back then.
How I wish that I could just have no restrictions and be like, oh, whatever pops into your head, you can do experiments on it. I'd be like, fuck yeah.
Man, Candice, you come out strong for this and before for the fucking empire.
Well, Candice, you should look into Unit 731.
Oh no,
I know what that is. I know what that is.
You would have fit right
anybody
in.
You never want to watch a movie that they should never watch? Watch the movie that was made about that fucking unit.
Remember when I said I was so good at vivisections?
Yeah. Was it the people behind the sun?
Yes, the people behind the sun. And I said, I swear to God, if Asher's ever requests it, I'm not doing it.
Putting in the fucking head, Candice.
By the way, Ashers, hope you're recovering well. If you want to do people behind the sun, just let me know. You wanted torture porn, Candice?
Yeah, that's there you go. Right? That's the original.
I was thinking more like hostile.
I love that the guy that was in charge of all that, the United States government, was like, look, man, we'll pardon you. Just give us your notes.
Oh, yeah. And I never mentioned my biological family from my mother's side, the only one I know about. They fled from Germany in the 1930s.
My husband's
like, you know, you got at least one Nazi in your family. It's like, yeah, probably distantly.
Yeah. Hey, you know what? Speaking of not recognizing Nazi shit, I totally missed the whole bit with the strudel in Inglourious Basterds.
Huh?
So, you know, he makes the Hans guy makes what's her name eat the strudel in Inglourious Basterds. And he's like, oh, it's fantastic. You have to have this strudel. Oh, wait, you have to have the whipped cream on it, too. That's what makes it, right? With a big glass of milk. So I didn't even think of this. Strudel is made with lard. Jewish people can't have lard. The whipped cream is made out of milk, and in Judaism, you're not allowed to have dairy with meat at the same time. So he was just being a complete fucking cock to her.
Surprise, surprise. Joseph Waltz is a Nazi being a dick.
Yeah, I totally did not even connect that for that scene. Just like, Jesus, man. Okay, so back to fun times. So Ruby's running up on the ridge, on Ruby Ridge, you might call it.
Oh, man.
Oh,
you know, as soon as she said ridge, I was like, oh, it's coming. I know it's coming.
Don't look into that. Look into Unit 731 in Ruby Ridge, everybody.
That's your feel-good assignment.
Yeah, that's a fun weekend.
Let's see. This week we got Kyle Rittenhouse, Nazis, Ruby Ridge, Unit whatever the fuck that number was.
731.
We should really be hitting the fucking Google algorithm pretty hard.
Oh, yeah. Right? Yeah. You know what? We'll hashtag
all of it.
Picking
up a ton of new listeners for one episode only.
Man, I know because of fucking Twitter, and they're so desperate for, you know, promoted tweets. Mm-hmm. They're so desperate for sponsors. I'm getting all of these advertisements for, like, white supremacy shit.
Yep.
It's like, what the fuck? Yep.
Dude, it's buck wild in Twitter,
not
man.
Not me. What the fuck?
No, Tim. She's dead on with it, man. Because, like, we go through, at work, we use a VPN to access the internet. So it's always a different location. If you just go to Twitter and it has no idea, no history on you, the ads it serves you are fucking wild.
Oh, so wait, hold on. So I don't sign into my Twitter account. Yeah, I just go to Twitter on like my browser.
Yeah, like incognito mode browser, VPN. Oh, it has no idea who you are.
Put myself in Missouri and see what comes up.
Yep, just put that you're Candice. You live in Missouri.
You'll start getting. To you.
My name is Candy. I'm a white girl.
Yep, white girl named Candy in Missouri.
I already have two kids. I'm still at a certain age. Yeah,
I keep Googling fucking unit 731 at about 2:30 in the morning every night.
What is that? Rule 34? So it's 731 and then rule 34. See what pops up.
Yeah. Oh God. Oh my God.
I think isn't that how Japan invented that thing where they jerk a guy off while he sings karaoke?
Oh man, I want to get on that show.
No, that's when they got into tentacles.
Yeah. Oh yeah, yeah, the tentacles. Yeah. So she runs up on the ridge, and
just thinking about that fucking karaoke show.
That's so crazy. Just fucking jacking a guy off while he's trying to sing. And that's a TV show.
I know it's a TV show.
I'd lose my concentration, I think. I don't know about you, Tim. But
I'm thinking Bohemian Rhapsody, I'm going for it.
I could do tequila. That'd be my request. We cut back to the camp, right? After Doug goes running up in the hills after her. And the fishing line, they set that up an alarm all the way around their base camp, right? And the alarm goes off. You know, it starts moving around. And they're like, oh, shit, you know, clearly something's around here. So he grabs his gun, Bobby does, and he goes running looking for it. Mm-hmm. And what does he find? But a tumbleweed has tripped it. So he's like, ah, shit. Runs back to the...
They just leave the tumbleweed there, too.
Take the fucking tumbleweed out, because guess what? Now your alarm is fucking invalid.
He spent all day putting that alarm up in the desert, and it's gone now because of a tumbleweed. Fucking idiot. So, yeah, he goes back to the camp, and because they've loaded all the dead bodies into the truck, and the truck door is open, and his mom's missing. So it's like, shit, I guess they took her to go? I don't... So... He's like, God damn
it. Wait, is this before or after he sees her getting eaten out?
Well, no, we're coming up to that. Because then he grabs his gun and he goes running to the mine entrance. And this is when he sees the dude eating his mom out.
Mm-hmm. I love this movie.
Yeah. So
can the movie go too far?
So Bobby's like, what the fuck? Unloads an entire clip and just misses.
Oh, yeah.
He's
Billy
running
Drago.
Away and shooting. Just...
Save
and then
bullets.
The stupidest fucking. I have written down at one point. That was the plan. Was this the fucking plan?
Yeah.
How they get him to that fucking RV?
Oh God! So they lead him back to the RV, Tim. Thank you so much. By the way,
this is so fucking stupid and ridiculous. Maybe. Just stop. Turn around. Get down on one fucking knee. Aim down the fucking barrel, squeeze the trigger, don't pull it, and put two in his fucking chest.
No,
end the fucking story.
I wanted to point out that this character is Billy Drago.
Yes, I saw when I saw that in the fucking title, actor. I was like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
Also, he was supposed to be a conjoined twin, but they ended up scrapping that at the last minute because they couldn't get it to work right.
Yeah. Didn't want to pay him double. Shut up, Tim.
So he's the only... quote-unquote mutant that doesn't actually have a mutation.
We need to stop talking about conjoined twins so much on this show.
Well, you guys get the good real, doctor and this. Well,
you guys get real
I
tasteless
about,
with it.
Oh, really, Eddie?
With those discussions. Yes, you do.
Okay.
Candice.
So, Eddie, if one of them wants to have sex and the other one doesn't, is that considered rape?
It's only a half account.
It's still equal.
Yeah.
I mean, there is a witness.
That's true. But there are technically three witnesses, and two of them say it was consensual. So.
Ah.
Yeah, there we go.
Yeah, that's
and
the
since
old...
it's only half a vote because it's a woman?
It's the like old
1.5.
Oh, that's right. Doesn't even count. Oh,
yeah, that's true. It's the old gang rape rule, right?
Yeah, if, exactly.
Nine out of 10 people are for it.
9 out of 10 people.
Oh, God. I saw.
Oh, that's why that last dentist was so angry.
Oh, God. You think they all held the last dentist down and raped him? So he's like, fuck Crest. You know what? Fuck flossing your teeth. I'm done.
Exactly.
You all go to hell. My ass hurts. They didn't even use any Novocaine. So, yeah, they lure him back to the RV. Okay, so the RV, if you're in the desert, right, I think having access to, like, shade, water, air conditioning, things like that might be important. Mm-hmm. No, they have a different plan. They go ahead.
Stock up at the store. Yeah.
They go ahead and crack 4 propane tanks inside of the RV. Right? And they lined the door.
Isn't this RV? Nope.
They lined the bottom of the door with strike anywhere matches. And then he runs into the fucking RV. Lures the mutant over there, cracks
up. After running blindly, shooting at this guy, yes. Right? He accidentally finds this guy eating his mom, okay?
Yeah.
Then he starts running and shooting and turning around and shooting blindly at
wasting
him,
all of his fucking bullets.
Every bullet just empties it.
Just to get this guy to chase him into the RV, and hopefully he does exactly the one thing that needs to happen after they get out.
Yeah. So they
both of them are in it, by the way. Put just what? Let the fucking sister stay outside.
Yeah.
Right? Have a hide.
Use her
honestly,
as bait.
If she dies, it's a mercy killing.
Yeah, use her as bait. You
She's
line
been
up
raped
the shot.
By two mutants. She's got a lot to deal with. It's easier just to kill her.
I'm sorry. Yeah, if you want a distraction for this family, Candice, exactly. This girl should be fucking pulling her tits out because that would stop them dead in their tracks for at least a second or two, right?
Yeah, and then while they're fucking her, you just come up and shoot them.
No, just pull the tits out. That's it. They're going to stop for a second, look, and then bang. That's it. Shoot.
To be fair, I think that would work with most scenarios, though, Tim.
That's true. Yes.
That's why I always said if I robbed a bank, I'd do it topless.
It's a good idea. Hostage negotiator, just get
no
a chick
with big
tits.
No one's looking at your fucking face. No one's actually thinking about what you're saying.
Yeah. Good idea, Candice. You're basically invisible once the tits are out.
Yeah, so no. Listen to me and say, give me all your money. They're just like, what?
So Bobby...
you want singles? Here you go.
Singles. Stuff it in my G-string. Yeah. No, so dude reaches into the RV and Bobby grabs a bungee cord and like bungees his wrists. So he's stuck.
So this plan now consists of shooting at this guy blindly, running away, getting him to chase you into the RV, getting him to put both of his hands through a fucking wall so you can tie him up with this bungee cord, break a fucking window out, and then wait for him to get his hands untied, okay?
Yep.
Go to another fucking area, open up that fucking door, strike those matches, and blow himself up.
But by God, it works.
This part suck my dick movie. I'm sorry.
Tim.
This is the stupidest part of the movie.
Tim, it worked.
Does it? Because he's not dead.
No, he's mostly dead. But yeah, so.
Yeah, the whole fucking thing is blown up like fucking Oklahoma City, except for fucking Billy Drago.
Yeah. And he's just laying on the ground, though, with like a chunk of shrapnel stuck.
That's going to get us another hit on the fucking algorithm. Oklahoma City. Yeah.
Oklahoma City. Yeah, there you go. Your old Kaczynski. You have to put the name in there too, right? Right. Tell everybody we're against the Industrial Revolution, like him.
Anti-vax.
Anti-vax. Yeah, we got to bring that up too. No,
lizard people running the government.
Yeah. So dude's just pinned down with a fucking piece of shrapnel in him, and so finally, then the sister can go up and take his ass out. So she got one kill.
Maybe that'll help her with all of her PTSD she's undoubtedly going to have.
Yeah, not to mention the flipper baby she's going to have.
Yeah, that too.
Ooh, part two, yeah.
That's why they're going to California.
No, Candice, this is a conservative family. They can't get an abortion.
Oh, that's true.
Mm, what happens
you
here?
Love it like it's your own.
Mm-hmm.
In a
Plus, what
attic.
State are they in this house? Oh, they're in California. So
yeah. That's true.
Also, in California, you can kill that baby up to 9 years old, right?
Yep, yep. It's perfectly legal to kill babies up to 9 years old, Tim, in California.
And that's called a 45th trimester abortion.
Yeah, yeah. But the trick is
Candice, you said you weren't good at math.
Well, the trick is you have to do it at their school with a gun, and then it's legal. Then it's fine. We'll never do anything to fix that. So, so then dude follows fucking Ruby. Doug does. And she offers him the baby. She's like, here's your baby back, dude. I don't know why I, came up in the hills with it, but whatever. And as she's handing it to him, Lizard fucking out of the trees just jumps down and whips Doug's ass with that spike strip.
Oh, he's beating hits him straight across the face with it.
Oh, he's fucking him up, yeah.
Yeah.
He's not a pretty boy anymore.
No, he's dead. I mean, this guy's fucked, right? So then Lizard goes and starts chasing Ruby and the baby. Yeah, corners her ass. They're going to take her out. Doug pulls himself up and finally...
looks at the wedding ring, right?
Looks at his wedding ring, yep, remembers.
He's a white guy.
Remembers he's white. Yep. Yep. He's like, I'm white.
Wife. He's a wife guy.
He's like, I'm white and I'm pissed is what he says. And then
and my wife is dead. And I got to impress my sister-in-law now.
Oh yeah. 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 Cause he's going to be fucking her.
Need somebody to help take care of that kid too.
Yeah. We're going to have to Roto-Rooter the kid out of there, but clean the place up before I go in there. But, he grabs a shotgun and just starts beating the shit out of Lizard with the fucking butt end of it.
Mm-hmm.
Fires one off to the gut. Bam! Lizard gets back up. Another one.
This is when you remember that earlier in the movie it was established this is just buckshot.
Yep. Oh, that's right. Yeah, he points out that it's just buckshot.
Still, doesn't that fuck you up?
Yeah.
It would hurt.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it ain't gonna kill you immediately. But it'll fuck
you
up.
But enough of it.
especially a gut shot with it ain't going to kill you. Then one to the neck with the buckshot. And then another one to the fucking back. And I just wrote down, God bless guns.
Yep. Yeah, what this part is very cathartic. You're like, fuck yeah, get him, Doug.
So he's fucking down. Ruby's like, all right, here's your baby back. Just don't shoot me too, please. Everything's happy. But oh shit, Lizard pops up like the Undertaker, grabs the shotgun, goes to end it all. And just then from the side with the assist, Ruby spears his ass into a cliff and they're both dead.
Goodbye, Ruby Tuesday.
Then Bobby and Brenda walk back to the burning remains of the RV.
Yeah, and you see them walking like through the flames. And all I could think about was, through the fire and the flames we carry on.
Oh, man. Love some Dragon Force.
I'm very concerned about the level of UV rays that this baby's skin is getting. That baby's going to have a fucking sunburn.
No, this is no happy ending. They're all dead.
Yeah, but where the fuck are they going to go?
Yeah, I mean...
That's everyone dead. So now what? You just blew up any fucking means of transportation you have.
Yeah.
What are you going to do? You're dead dog tired. There's no water. You got to walk at least however long it took your fucking cop dad to walk from there to the fucking gas station.
Best case scenario, you go back to the gas station, load up on water, gas, in whatever containers you can find. Go back to Nuketown and power up the generator. Sit down and watch them.
You're going back to Nuketown? You're fucking crazy.
Well, Tim, they got TV there at least.
I don't know. I think you get to the gas station, there's got to be a phone working in the gas station.
No, they're going to have to rebuild. They're going to have to construct a new life in Nuketown, Tim.
I go back to the gas station and pick up all that fucking loot that's laying around now, right?
But, hey, it's not just it, because at the end of the movie, you realize they're not alone.
Nope, because the camera pans out and we see goggles. Well, through the perspective of goggles.
And that's when you get the Hills Have Eyes, too. Which is a fun movie because the people who are the
National
victims,
Guard, right?
Yes, they're actually military, so that's fun.
Yeah.
Well, they're not national. They're the National Guard. They're not the military, Candice.
They could probably fight better than you, Tim. Let me just put it that way.
I don't know about that, but
technically,
I can pass a lie detector test. I'll tell you that.
Technically, part of the DOD, so I guess military.
But yeah, if you like this movie, you should watch the sequel.
Definitely watch the sequel. That one's a lot of fun too. And this one, again, a lot of fun. Like I said, I watched it once when I rented it back in the day. Refreshing to watch it again.
And it's like, also such a time capsule of 2006 because we didn't mention it, but Doug is a cell phone salesman.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right.
He has a place just to...
Oh, and he's making tons of money, it seems, too, right?
Oh, yeah, because he offers to buy the gas, remember? And the dad's like, not this time, Junior. Yeah, fantastic movie, though.
And so it's like the dawn of like cell phones being everywhere and the internet being in every home. It's like just this time period where everybody's just scared and frantic about everything.
Yeah, it wasn't unusual that you couldn't get cell phone reception somewhere.
Yeah.
Like it is today in a movie. Like, come on.
A town 10 minutes from me that has no cell phone coverage of any carrier.
Candice, where the fuck do you live? Not only that, but what time do you live in? What the fuck century are you
in? I'm telling you, you think this stuff is...
with 12 fucking people with a giraffe as mayor and no fucking cell phone connection.
I'm telling you, you think these movies are so far-fetched, but they're not. There are places like this that actually exist.
No, it's...
What's crazy is the people who live in those places are never going to see this movie.
True.
That's true. Yeah. No, and it's... those are some of the episodes of Last Drive-In that I like the most, or the Hicksploitation ones where Joe Bob's talking about. I mean, he wrote the whole book on it, basically, how that saved Hollywood, you know, the... Low budget B movie, you know, the people that Hollywood would look down their nose at. Rebuild the entire thing with the drive-in theater and the B movies. Yeah,
and it plays on a fear of backwoods people. Oh, the hill folk. What are they up to? They aren't on the grid, so they must be insane and crazy and mutants and they want to rape your daughters. But also, as someone who is from those hills... As someone who is the Hicks that they make fun of, it's like, it's really not that bad. If you're not used to it, like if Tim came to my town, he'd be freaked out of his fucking mind.
I'd be burned at the stake within 24 hours, I guarantee.
But you wouldn't be, but you're thinking the entire time, you're like, these people are going to kill me if I say the wrong thing.
That's why I got to talk faster.
Yep.
Baffle them with bullshit. It reminds me of a book I read called White Trash, and it was about the history of the poor white class in America. And this is the only group of people that you're allowed to make fun of.
Yeah.
Poor white trash. There's the only ones that everyone agrees that you're not going to get offended if someone makes fun of them.
But it's funny that paranoia comes out through the movies of like, well, we've shuffled these people away and disregarded them. They're going to come back to bite us, you know?
Yes.
And they did, because they elected Trump. So
exactly. That was the point of the book I read.
Yep. So, God, I think that does it for The Hills Have Eyes. Go out and check it out if you haven't. Tim, buddy, I'm going to ask you first. Is there anything on the internet that you want people to pay attention to?
I want to get people's eyes more on guys getting stuck porn. I think we've discovered something here.
Yeah, with the car.
Getting stuck in an air conditioner vent, right? Getting stuck on a ladder.
He's fixing something and he gets stuck.
Come on. I think we've come on to a great idea. Besides that, I'm sure there's some mini bins coming out on Grind Bin. If I haven't been on Mustachio Podcast for a while, it's a crime. We should be on it with what was the movie we just picked on? The movie we were just talking about doing with the Mustachio Podcast.
Oh, there's a bunch of them. It was, the Pat movie we were talking about?
Oh, yeah.
Stewart Saves His
Wild Wild West.
Wild Wild West.
Wild West, that's it, yes.
Okay, what about you, Candice?
Oh, just the same old shit, at HorrorHoochie69 on Instagram and Twitter.
Fantastic.
I should be recording episodes with the Grind Bin and with everything I learned from movies, but it's in the future. It's not happening yet.
Okay. Fantastic. And you can always follow Tim at Yobo Gold or me at Eddie the Axe or at Bloody Bits on Twitter. Now for the chat AI portion, I've had it generate a review of The Hills Have Eyes from the perspective of Pauly Shore, AKA the Weasel.
Why?
Yo, dudes and dudettes, it's your buddy, Pauly Shore, the Weasel, here to give you a totally tubular review of The Hills Have Eyes. So grab some popcorn, kick back, and let's dive into the wild ride. That's as much as I'm going to read, because it's fucking terrible.
Oh, thank God.
It goes
That's pretty fucking damn good, though.
It's not bad. Yeah. I'll give you the last sentences of it. So grab your crew, turn off the lights, and prepare for a wild and freaky ride through the hills. Party on, dudes.
I want to hear Trump's review of this on the AI.
Trump's review?
Yeah.
All right. Well, Tim, you'll have to figure out how to run the AI. But until you do, if you need more entertainment.
I downloaded the app on my iPhone, so.
Oh, okay. But until Tim does that for you, if you need some more entertainment, you can go to patreon.com/bloodypits to subscribe to our Patreon and get access to the Blood Bank with now nearly 5,953 full-length movies for you to choose from.
Including this one, right?
Yep. Yeah. Let's see what some of the newest ones we've added are here. From 2018, we've got Polterheist. Two gangsters are given 72 hours to discover the whereabouts of a stash of drugs stolen by their boss. The only problem is they just murdered him, so they have to go get a psychic. Oh, I got to watch that. That sounds fantastic, Tim. Oh, what else do we have? Be Afraid from 2017. In order to protect his family, Dr. John Chambers must solve the town's deadly secret, which lives within the darkest shadows of the night. Literally describes nothing. and
sounds erotic.
We've got Little Gory Corey from 1993. Abused by his older brother and stepmother, a high school student takes drastic steps to regain his independence.
Which
rapes
Corey
his father.
It?
Rapes his father. This is Todd Fortune.
Well, okay. Misfortune.
You know what's
like.
Funny is that on Twitter, you know, people will follow me and I'll follow them back and they'll post That's about funny. These movies. And then I like won't think about it because I'm like, I've never heard of that movie and I'll keep scrolling. Mm-hmm. And then I'll scroll through the blood bank and I'm like, how the fuck is it that I heard about this movie twice in the same day? And I realize that it's actually our listeners that I follow Twitter and they watch these fucking movies.
Yeah. No, we have a couple of them that have tweeted some of the fantastic findings that they have found in the blood bank. And if you'd like to be them, patreon.com/bloodybits.
And if it's not there, you can request it and we'll find it.
That's true, Tim. So for Tim and Candice, I'm Eddie, and this is how we end it.